2009 was the year of a lot of change. You had Takashi Sasaki running the Apache Army, and it was not doing very well at all, so much so that he would try to bring in Kentaro Kanemura to feud over the name to create interest. Well, that would end up upsetting the sponsors so much that they would end up pulling out. They wanted nothing to do with Kanemura, and Takashi Sasaki would end up having to close down the Apache Army. Well, he would end up starting up a new promotion following that, and it would be called Freedoms. And Freedoms is going to start off as a very small promotion with just five guys on the roster, only being able to run one show a month in Shinkiba. It is doing better than what the Apache Army is doing, but it is still a very small promotion. Then you had two nostalgia promotions being created in Shin-W ING and Shin-FMW. Shin-W ING was started up by Miki Ibaragi, the founder of Wing, and he would have a nostalgia show at Shinkiba that would do pretty decent, but any other show that he would do after that did not do as well. But going into 2010, he's going to continue to try to promote these nostalgia shows, and same thing with Tarzan Goto. He is going to start up his own nostalgia FMW promotion called Shin-FMW. He had the first show at the very end of 2009, teaming up with Asushi Onita, going up against Mr. Pogo. And these matches are, you know, just kind of these wild brawl main events with the old FMW guys that are now over 40 years old, and horrible mid-card and undercard matches to fill out the show. So Tarzan Goto's going into 2010 is going to also try and promote these shows every couple months. And then also you had Big Japan completely change what they were doing, and this actually really worked for them, where they really tried promoting younger wrestlers. Masashi Takeda, Yuko Miyamoto continued to be pushed up to the top. And Big Japan, as a result, would be one of the hottest promotions going into 2010 with a great reputation for incredible matches and wrestlers that people really cared about and are young also. So they got a lot of time to continue to be built up as superstars.
Kentaro Kanemura would work a 0-1 show on January 1st at Korakuen Hall. Can you go over his match and what his status with 0-1 is?
Yeah, so Kentaro Kanemura is going to team up with Masato Tanaka here. Kanemura's home promotion of XWF has not been doing very well. It's barely surviving at this point. And due to Kanemura's friendship with Tanaka, Tanaka has gotten Kanemura some bookings with 0-1 for some of the bigger shows like Korakuen Hall. And they're going to team up here to take on Mr. X and Mr. XX, who are Minoru Fujita and Takuya Sugawara. They're doing this mask gimmick for 0-1 at the time. And in this match, Fujita and Sugawara, they would end up sending Tanaka and Kanemura out of the ring, and they would end up delivering topes to them on the outside. Kanemura would try to send Sugawara in the crowd, but Sugawara would end up reversing it and sending Kanemura into the seats instead, and they would end up all brawling. Tanaka would come over to help out Kanemura, and both Kanemura and Tanaka would end up setting up Fujita and Sugawara onto tables, as Kanemura and Tanaka would both deliver double table dives, sending Fujita and Sugawara through the tables. Tanaka would end up going for a sliding deep, and Fujita would end up covering Tanaka with the Brahmin Brothers finishing move called Nobody's Perfect for a two count. Then Kanemura would end up placing a box cover over Fujita's face, and Tanaka would end up hitting a sliding D on Fujita for the win. So Tanaka and Kanemura end up getting the win. Like I said, Kanemura is going to be working semi-regularly for 0-1 here in 2010 due to his friendship with Tanaka.
Freedoms would have their first show of the year on January 14th at Shinkiba, with one of the top faces of the promotion going heel. Can you go over the show for us?
Yeah, so they would announce a crowd of 243 fans for this show. It's pretty much going to be the standard of what Freedoms is going to do throughout the rest of the year at Shinkiba. The opening match would be the Winger and Kamui teaming up with Asian Cougar, who I talked about previous episodes. He was a WMF junior heavyweight. He's going to compete in Freedoms, and they're going to team up to take on Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Key, and Ken 45. In this match, Kamui would end up delivering a dropkick to a chair right in Brahmin Key's face, and then Kamui would end up going to the top to hit a Firebird splash on Brahmin Key, when the Great Kajika would end up coming into the ring, and he would end up putting his claw on Brahmin Key, with Kamui having no choice but to dropkick Great Kajika since he wouldn't leave the ring and he's not a part of the match. Well, then Kamui would end up jumping off a chair onto the middle rope and hitting a moonsault on Brahmin Key for the win. Afterwards, Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Key, and Ken 45, they would all run in after Kajika and attack him. And so the last scene you see is them running off together. And then Ricky Fuji would end up taking on Tajiri in a singles match. Ricky would end up hitting a kamikaze on Tajiri and then sending him into the ropes. But Tajiri would end up hitting a sunset flip and pulling Ricky's pants down. And then Tajiri would end up spitting green mist into Ricky's ass, so, and then rolling him up for a small package for the win. So a very creative ending spot here to a match probably not too many people know even exist. And then afterwards, Kajika's music would begin to play as the Great Kajika would end up coming out wearing this KKK-like outfit with the Brahmin Brothers lifting him up, as the Great Kajika would announce that he is now starting up his own heel group called the Kajika Army with the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45 as members. So all of a sudden, the Great Kajika going into 2010 is now going to be the top heel of the Freedoms promotion, even though he had been pretty much basically the top babyface for the first couple shows of the promotion. So going forward, Great Kajika and the Brahmin Brothers are now going to be aligned going up against the Freedoms team. And then the semi-main event of the show is Takashi Sasaki, Jun Kasai, and Masashi Takeda taking on Tatsuhiro Takeiwa, Magnitude Kishiwada, and Minoru Fujita. They would end up all brawling all over the building at Shinkiba with Takeda and Kishiwada. They would begin slapping one another. They would end up getting back in the ring with Takeiwa, Kishiwada, and Fujita, all focusing on Takashi Sasaki's arm. And then Fujita would end up coming off the top rope with Sasaki getting his knees up. And then Sasaki would make the hot tag to Kasai, who would come in and hit a flying dropkick to Fujita, and then begin exchanging lariats with Kishiwada before knocking Kishiwada down, and then tagging in Takeda, who would come in and deliver a suplex to Kishiwada, and then Takeda would end up tagging in Sasaki, who would come in against Takeiwa and hit a swinging DDT to him. Takeda would then end up coming in and hitting a back suplex on Takeiwa, but Takeiwa would end up coming back and hitting a Michinoku driver, and then follow that up with the Death Valley Bomb on Takeda to get the win. So Takeiwa ends up getting the win over the young wrestler, Masashi Takeda, and this is really kind of the beginning of Masashi Takeda being pushed in Freedoms as one of the top guys as a non-deathmatch wrestler, since Freedoms is not doing any deathmatches at this point. And then the main event of the show is going to be Jintaro defending his independent junior heavyweight title, which I've talked about many episodes ago. It was the old FMW junior heavyweight title, and the title belt still says FMW on it, but is now just a pretty much an independent title that goes around from promotion to promotion. And right now, Jintaro is the champion, and he's going to defend it against Takuya Sugawara. I'm not going to really talk too much about this match, because I'll go over it more later, I'm sure, but Jintaro, I'm not a big fan of what he's doing right now. He's not really having that great of matches. He's trying, and you know, they're being pretty much promoted as these great matches, but I'm really not a big fan of these matches, and as a result, I'm just not going to cut right to the end, where Jintaro would end up getting a figure four on Sugawara, and then Sugawara would end up trying to fight out of it while trying to get out, but eventually Sugawara would end up just tapping out. And so, like I said, this goes 18 minutes. There's nothing really of note to talk about, but like I said, they're really kind of trying to push Jintaro as one of the top guys, as this great wrestler, even though I'm personally just finding them boring and not really eventful matches.
Tarzan Goto would hold another Shin FMW show on January 24th, with a former FMW wrestler appearing on this show. Can you go over some of the matches on this show?
Yeah, so this would be the second Shin FMW show that Tarzan Goto is running. The first show was the previous month where he would team up with Onita. Well, this show's not going to have Onita on it, so Tarzan Goto is going to try and fill it out with some more FMW wrestlers. So he's going to bring in some different guys on the show in the main event. They would announce a crowd of 150 fans, so I'm sure this show did not do very well overall, all things considered. But that's going to be a staple of this promotion, especially this year, that I'll be going over more later in the episode. One of the matches is Yuta Nakata teaming up with Io Shirai. They're going to go up against Great Sata and Mio Shirai. And so Nakata and Sata, they're from the Shinamachi promotion. And so Tarzan Goto is pretty much reaching out to this very, very small promotion to get these indie guys on his card, to kind of fill the card out. They're not very good. They're kind of the indie sleaze wrestlers that a lot of people know about, you know, that they don't really know the wrestlers. They're so small and they're not very good. But, you know, there's tons of these promotions all around Japan, and Tarzan Goto is bringing in this bringing in these guys to work his Shin FMW shows pretty much throughout the year. And then most people know Io Shirai, but most people don't know that she has a sister, Mio Shirai, who was a wrestler. She actually got Io Shirai into wrestling at first, and she's no longer wrestling, but the sisters here would end up going up against each other in this mixed tag. Mio and Io, they would end up starting off with Io hitting a drop kick to Mio, and then Mio would end up tagging in Sato, who would end up slamming Io, and then end up throwing her into the corner as Mio Shirai, and Sato would end up taking turns laying kicks to Io Shirai. Io would end up coming back by hitting a flying drop kick at Sata, and then Mio would end up coming in, and Ito would end up having to hit a reverse tiger driver on her, and then follow that up with a moonsault, but eventually she would end up tagging in Nakata, and Nakata and Sakata would end up going at it with one another, with Nakata hitting a swanton bomb on Sata for the win. So this was just kind of a fun fact that Io Shirai actually wrestled in the Tarzan Goto Shin FMW promotion many years ago. And then there would be a title match on this show. The title belt would be for the New Half Championship. And what the New Half Championship is, a title belt pretty much for a transvestite promotion that is ran by Tarzan Goto's friend, who helps run the restaurant that he owns with him. She gets a bunch of these wrestlers on the show in this promotion. And these wrestlers are not good whatsoever. To call them wrestlers is a compliment even. Reina Ayukawa, she's the champion. She would probably be considered leagues above everybody else. And she is probably just a poor wrestler. Everyone else is just horrible. Some of these wrestlers are not even trained, really. In this match, Reina Ayukawa, she defends the New Half Championship against Carrot. Ayukawa, she would charge at Carrot, who would end up grabbing Ayukawa and just tossing her around. And after that, it just becomes amateur hour with just a bunch of takedowns. Carrot would eventually get Ayukawa in a camel clutch, and she would just put it on her forever. Ayukawa would eventually take Carrot to the outside, and they would end up brawling to the ramp, and then eventually Carrot would end up picking Ayukawa and dropping her onto the ramp. They would end up getting back in the ring as Ayukawa would end up hitting a bulldog. Just a lot of nothing in between these spots. Like I said, this is by no means even a decent match. Carrot would end up delivering a takedown repeatedly, and then eventually they would end up just grappling on the mat before Ayukawa would eventually just roll up Carrot for the win. So like I said, horrible match, but this is just what Tarzan Goto has been willing to do to get his mid-card and undercard filled out. He's going to have these wrestlers, you know, from Shinamachi Pro, from this transvestite promotion, and you know, they are just not good wrestlers at all, but Tarzan Goto doesn't care. He is just focusing on the main events, and the main events being, you know, FMW Street Fight nostalgia matches to help hopefully bring fans come in, you know, bring them back, having them continue to come back to his shows. The next match would be the semi-main event, Goemon and Masahiro Sase, who's another very small independent wrestler, but Masahiro Sase has a lot of money. I'm going to go over him in a future episodes, I'm sure. He ends up using his money to team up with Onita in these exploding barbed wire death matches. They would end up teaming up to take on Madaka and Tomonobu Matsumoto, another Shinamachi pro wrestler. In this match, Goemon would end up going after Matsumoto and hitting a pedigree on him, and then eventually Goemon would end up kicking Matsumoto low and rolling him up for a cradle for the win. So a nothing match, nothing to really note, even with Goemon, an actual, you know, least previously good wrestler in this match. It's, and Madaka is a really good wrestler as well. Really nothing of note. And then the main event would be Tarzan Goto teaming up with Hisagatsu Oya and Riki Fuji, and they are reuniting the Lethal Weapon group that Goto had started up in FMW right before he left FMW. So this was like early 95. They all turned heel with one another right before Tarzan Goto left FMW, and so they're reuniting this group for one more time. So they're dressed up in their all black outfits that they wore in FMW, and they're going to take on the wing team of Mr. Pogo, the Winger, and the returning Super Leather. And so this is the big get for this show, is Mike Kirshner, Mike Pinsel, returning under the Super Leather gimmick, and he is promoted on this show. And Pogo and the Winger, they come out with a fake leather face, and the fans start booing. They really believe that, you know, Tarzan Goto has lied to them, that, you know, we're going to have the original leather face, and they bring in a fake leather face, and everyone knows about it, and they start booing. They're really upset over this. When the match would get started, and they would brawl all over the place, Tarzan Goto would end up laying out the fake leather face before going after the Winger, and they would continue to brawl when the door to Shinkiba would open, and out would come Super Leather, and he would rush to the ringside area with his chainsaw and begin chasing all the fans all over the place. As, like I said, the original Super Leather is back. This is the first time he's back in Japan since wrestling for Kanemura's XWF promotion back in 2008. And Super Leather would end up coming in the ring and picking up the fake leather face and hitting a brain buster onto him. Riki would end up going after Super Leather with Super Leather laying him out with a kick before going at it with Tarzan Goto. Goto would end up going outside and just begin throwing chairs at Leatherface, with Leather blocking all the chairs with the table. Pogo then would end up coming over and begin cutting open Riki Fuji in the ring, as Goto would end up having to go over at Mr. Pogo and trying to save Riki, when Super Leather would end up picking up a knife and begin cutting Riki Fuji in the forehead with it, and then Super Leather would begin choking Oya with the chain. And then Super Leather would end up grabbing his toothbrush with nails on it and begin using it on Riki, and then follow that up with grabbing a chain and begin choking Oya with it. And then Super Leather would hold on to Riki as Mr. Pogo would begin stabbing him with his sickle. And then Pogo would wrap his chain around Goto, but Goto would manage to escape, followed by Super Leather getting tied up on the ropes, and then as Goto would begin stabbing him. And then Mr. Pogo would begin putting lighter fluid in his mouth, but Goto would end up rushing over and punching Pogo in the face, causing lighter fluid to fly everywhere. Super Leather then would end up hitting a lariat on both Riki Fuji and Oya, and then Goto would end up hitting a clothesline on Super Leather, sending him over the top rope, with Riki diving over the top rope onto Super Leather. And then Super Leather and Riki would end up getting back in the ring, with Super Leather hitting a tombstone on Riki, and then trying to hit a powerbomb on Riki, but Riki would manage to reverse it and turn it into a Hurricane Rana. And then Tarzan Goto's side would begin throwing chairs in the ring, with fans throwing them in as well. And then Goto would end up hitting a powerbomb on a maskless Winger onto two chairs, and then follow that up with hitting a lariat on the Winger for the win. So Tarzan Goto, Riki Fuji, and Hisagatsu Oya get the win. The Lethal Weapon team get the win for the final time as a group. Pogo would end up getting on the mic with Goto throwing a chair at him. So Mr. Pogo and Tarzan Goto, they're going to be the top, pretty much the top two guys in this promotion. So overall, this match wasn't really that good, but I'm sure it was awesome live. I'll go over it more later, how these matches are awesome live, but they don't really, you know, translate to tape very well. But, you know, all these matches prior to it, the whole undercard was just horrible, and you can't really promote a promotion based off just, hey, there's going to be one awesome match live that, you know, you're going to be around seeing all these chairs and tables fly all over the place, but you got to sit through, you know, 2 hours of god-awful wrestling before you get to them. So as a result, this promotion is going to struggle going forward the rest of the year.
Freedoms would come back to Shinkiba on February 9th. Can you go over some of the matches on this show?
So they would announce a crowd of 213 fans for this show, which is the lower end of the standard that they're drawing here at Shinkiba. They have a loyal fan base, but I'm sure even some of these fans decided that this show was not a must-see to go to. The opening match would be Takashi Sasaki and Kamui taking on Brahmin Brothers Shu and Ki, and they're going to have Great Kajika in a suit and tie in their corner. The Brahmin Brothers would end up running in, attacking Sasaki right away, and Kajika would end up getting in the ring, and they would throw Kajika into the corner at Sasaki. Kajika would then end up grabbing his microphone or his megaphone and speaking right into it, into Takashi Sasaki's ear. They would end up brawling in the crowd, where the Brahmin Brothers would end up throwing a garbage can at Kamui, and then they would eventually end up getting back in the ring with Kajika trying to hit Kamui with a chair, but instead he would end up accidentally hitting Brahmin Key over the head with it instead, and then Kamui would end up rolling up Key with a Kamui clutch for the win. So Kamui and Takashi Sasaki get the win after Great Kajika screws up. He was doing that a lot as a face the year prior, and now he's a heel and he's still doing it, but now doing it to the heel side. The Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45, they would end up getting really upset over Kajika for his screw up, and they would all end up going to the back upset at one another, fighting, bickering, as the group is already looking like they have issues with one another. And then the semi-main event would be Jintaro, the Winger, and Riki Fuji defeating Tajiri, Minoru Fujita, and Takuya Sugawara after the Winger would end up hitting a senton off the top on Fujita for the win. Afterwards, Jintaro would end up getting on the mic and asking for Tajiri to join up with the Freedom Side now that Kajika has gone heel and joined up with the Brahmin Brothers. But as he would end up putting his hand out for Tajiri to shake, Tajiri would end up just walking away. Takashi Sasaki then would end up coming into the ring and trying to talk Tajiri into joining them. Hey, Tajiri, your issues were with Kajika last year, not with us. You know, now join up with us and go up against him. You know, go up against the Kajika army. Well, Takashi Sasaki, he would put his hand out for Tajiri to shake, and Tajiri would put his hand out also, but then pull it back. Eventually, Sasaki and Jintaro would try talking him into joining the Freedoms group when the Great Kajika's music would begin to play, as Kazuhiko Ogasawara, Minoru Fusawa, and the Brahmin Brothers would all come out with Kajika lifted up on their shoulders, as Kajika would get on the mic and declare war on the Freedom's Army. You know, hey, you're trying to recruit Tajiri to go up against us. Well, now I am going to declare war on all of you guys, and the Kajika Army is going to take out the Freedom's Army, pretty much. The main event of the show is going to be Jun Kasai and Masashi Takeda taking on Magnitude Kishiwada and Tatsuhiro Takeiwa. Kasai and Takeda would end up charging at Kishiwada and Takeiwa right away, and they would brawl all around ringside. Eventually, Takeda and Kishiwada would end up getting back in the ring with Takeda putting an ankle lock on Kishiwada, with Takeiwa having to make the save for his partner. Kasai would end up coming in, but he would end up getting met with a lariat by Kishiwada. But eventually, Kasai would end up hitting a lariat of his own, but Kishiwada would follow that up by coming right back and hitting a suplex on Kasai. Takeda and Takeiwa would end up getting tagged in, with Takeda hitting a German suplex on Takeiwa, but Takeiwa would come back and hit a Michinoku driver, and then follow that up with hitting a Death Valley bomb on Takeda. Kishiwada would end up coming in the ring and hitting a last ride powerbomb on Kasai, as Takeiwa would end up hitting a lariat on Takeda, and then Takeiwa would end up trying for a powerbomb, but Takeda would manage to escape, and as Takeiwa would end up going for a lariat, Takeda would end up ducking it and hitting a German suplex on Takeiwa, and then hit a spear on him for the win. So Takeda gets the win over Takeiwa. Takeiwa is complaining that his shoulder was up before the three count. So this is a big win for Takeda in a non-deathmatch setting. And Takeiwa has a 90s junior New Japan wrestler name. So this is to set up Takeda and Takeiwa at the next Freedom show in March. They're going to go at it in a singles match.
Freedoms then would hold another show on March 10th at Shinkiba, with Takashi Sasaki announcing two wrestlers returning to the promotion. Can you go over some of the top matches and who the two returning wrestlers were?
Yeah, so they would announce a crowd of 227 fans for this show, which is a standard number at this point for Freedoms. The opening match would be Great Kajika teaming up with Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Key, and Abdullah Kobayashi, and they're going to go up against The Winger, Kamui, Antonio Honda, and Kitty Yano. And Great Kajika, he's wrestling in his suit and tie once again for this match. The majority of the match would consist of the Kajika army working on Kamui until Kamui would break free and hit a Pele kick on Kobayashi, and then hit an Acai moonsault on the Brahmin Brothers. Kajika would end up coming in and successfully throwing salt into Antonio Honda's face, and then Kajika would hold Honda down as Kobayashi would come off the top rope with an elbow, but he would end up accidentally hitting Kajika in the head with his elbow, so Honda would end up picking up the win over the Great Kajika. So the Freedoms team gets the win over the Kajika army, and then there's Riki Fuji taking on Kazuhiko Ogasawara, and this is about as kind of indie sleaze as you can get, when Karate Mummy a very small independent gimmick wrestler dressed up as a mummy that knows karate. He would end up coming in the ring first to distract Riki Fuji, allowing Ogasawara to jump Riki and then begin attacking him. Eventually, the karate mummy would end up interfering during the match and attacking Riki multiple times as they would end up on the outside with karate mummy holding Riki, but Riki would end up moving out of the way as Ogasawara would try to strike Riki and it accidentally hit the mummy instead, and then Riki and Ogasawara would brawl in the crowd to a double countout. So like I said, this is about as indie sleaze as you can get, bringing in, you know, such a small independent gimmick and go, you know, for really no reason other than to help Ogasawara in this really bad match. And then the next match is Masashi Takeda taking on Tatsuhiro Takeiwa. This was Freedom's attempt to elevate Takeda in a non-deathmatch setting, so they're, for the time being, kind of putting him away from the Kasai and Sasakis, and they're pairing him up here with Takeiwa in a non-deathmatch environment to kind of show that, hey, he can wrestle. You know, Freedom's right now is not a deathmatch promotion anyway, so let's, you know, Takeda can have good straight wrestling matches and it not be a deathmatch setting, so let's put him with another non-deathmatch wrestler in Takeiwa. And in this match, Takeiwa would end up hitting a Death Valley Bomb off the top rope on Takeda, with Takeda managing to kick out. Takeiwa would then try to put Takeda away by hitting him up with lariats. Eventually, Takeda would end up putting an ankle lock on Takeiwa, but Takeiwa would manage to get out of the ankle lock and then hit Takeda with another Death Valley Bomb. And as Takeiwa would set up to hit Takeda with a pile driver, Takeda would end up just collapsing as the 30-minute time limit would expire. And so it would end up being a draw. You know, again, this was just to kind of establish Takeda as, hey, look, this guy can go with an established veteran in a non-deathmatch environment. He can really wrestle as well. And as a result, they find a mutual respect with one another. And going forward, Takeda is going to team up with Takeiwa after this 30-minute match, which was good. It was okay. I mean, it was kind of built to be this classic. But at this point, just, you know, in Shinkiba, 200 fans, Freedoms right now really doesn't have the environment to really put on any type of classic matches. But like I said, this was okay. And then the next match is Takashi Sasaki teaming up with Jun Kasai and Madaka, and they were going to go up against Tajiri, Magnitude Kishiwada, and Minoru Fujita, and they would start off this match with the standard brawl all around the building before making it back up the ramp and then back into the ring. Madaka would end up facing off against Kishiwada and would end up hitting an impressive-looking Hurricane Rana on Kishiwada before tagging in Kasai, and then Kasai would end up facing off against Minoru Fujita, and Kasai would try to set up to hit a reverse Tiger Driver when Kishiwada would begin to charge at Kasai, but Madaka would end up coming off the top rope and hitting a flying drop kick to Kishiwada to make the save, followed by Takashi Sasaki delivering a kick to Tajiri's face. Kishiwada would then grab Madaka and try to hit a powerbomb with Madaka turning it into a Hurricane Rana, followed by Tajiri going for a kick that Madaka would end up ducking and then hitting Tajiri with a suplex. Madaka would end up going up to the top rope for a Firebird Splash, but Takashi Sasaki would end up getting shoved into the ropes, causing Madaka to fall off the top rope. Kishiwada would then end up picking up Madaka and hitting a last ride powerbomb on him, with Fujita covering him, but Madaka would manage to kick out. And then Madaka would end up getting up and charge at Fujita, but Fujita would move out of the way and then roll up Madaka for the win. So Fujita, Tajiri, and Kishiwada end up getting the win. Madaka, despite getting the loss, would really be the star of the match with how impressive his moves looked like in comparison to what everyone else was doing. Afterwards, the Kajika Army would end up coming out with their newest member, Antonio Honda. So even though Honda had defeated Kajika earlier in the show, he is now joined up with the Kajika Army. The Kajika Army has kind of turned into this cult-like heel group where even if you defeat Kajika, you have so much respect for him afterwards that you end up wanting to join with him. And so that's what's happened to Honda. He is now joined up with the Kajika Army. Kajika would end up getting on the mic and begin talking to Madako, who would be really upset by what Kajika was telling him. And Tajiri would end up having to try and calm Madaka down, and afterwards Tajiri and Madaka would shake hands. So this was kind of Tajiri's official turn as a face in Freedoms. And then Takashi Sasaki would end up getting on the mic afterwards, and he would end up announcing that High 69 is going to be returning to the ring. And then High 69 would come to the ring and announce that he will be wrestling at the next Freedom show in April at Shinkiba, and that also he's going to be changing his name. He's not going to be High 69 any longer. He's going to be going by his real first name, Hiroki. And he's the reason that he came up with the High 69 name to begin with was because the High was based out of Hiroki, and then the Ro is stands for 6 in Japanese, and the Ki stands for 9 in Japanese. So he always would go by High 69, but now he's going to be going by his real first name going forward. And then also Takashi Sasaki would announce that another wrestler is going to be coming back to Freedoms, and that's going to be Mama Sasaki. And Mama Sasaki's music would play, and Mama Sasaki would come out for the first time in nearly a year since he had his car accident. You know, the year prior he had a neck brace and he had suffered multiple injuries. Well, he's almost back to in-ring shape to be able to compete, and Mammoth would end up coming to the ring and announcing that he's going to be returning to the ring at the very first Freedoms show at Korakuen Hall on June 21st. So in 3 months, Mammoth feels like he will be in ring shape and capable of having, just joining up with Freedoms regularly and having a full-time regular schedule going forward, and his injuries are almost healed. And I made mention last episode that Takashi Sasaki, one of the reasons that he started Freedoms Up was so that Mama Sasaki and High 69 would have homes to come back to after their long-term injuries. He didn't want them coming back being freelancers, not having somewhere to regularly work. So going forward, they're going to be joining up with the roster here soon. And then the main event is going to be Jintaro taking on Takamichi Noku in an independent junior heavyweight title match. In this match, and I'm not a big fan of Jintaro at this point. I feel like he's trying to have these classic matches, and honestly, they just bore the hell out of me. But in this match, Taka would end up putting a crossface on Jintaro. Jintaro would manage to get out of the crossface, but then be met with a super kick by Taka. But then eventually, Jintaro would make it back to his feet and hit a super kick to Taka, and then put him in the sharpshooter with Taka tapping out. Like I said, I'm not a fan of Jintaro at this point. I kind of feel like he's just kind of this low-rent indie wrestler trying to have these classic matches, and they just bore me to tears at this point. I loved Jintaro early on a couple years ago when he was this junior heavyweight having these awesome matches in WEW, but at this point with them really pushing him, I just don't feel it. I just feel like he's just trying to have great matches, and they're it's just not clicking for me personally. But Takashi Sasaki is great friends with Jintaro. Takashi Sasaki is the main guy in charge. Jintaro is his, is going to get pushed regardless because of who he is. And again, he's not bad. He's just trying to be this awesome wrestler, and it's just not really clicking.
Freedoms would then have their April show on April 6th in Shinkiba. Can you talk about some of the matches on this show?
So this show would announce a crowd of 224 fans, which is pretty much average of what they've been doing, in that 220 to 240 range in Shinkiba every month, and it's good enough to continue to keep going for this small promotion. The opening match would be Takashi Sasaki taking on Hiroki. This is Hiroki's return to the ring for the first time in 2.5 years since his spinal injury. This is just kind of get him warmed up, so it's only going to be a 10-minute time limit match, and it's a very basic match where just Takashi Sasaki and Hiroki are going back and forth with strikes and then chops to one another. Sasaki would end up giving Hiroki a roundhouse kick, knocking him to the mat, and then Sasaki would end up putting a Hiroki in a single leg crab, and then trying to put him in a crossface, but the 10-minute time limit would expire, so again, nothing really of a match, just kind of get Hiroki back into ring shape. Jintaro would end up coming out afterwards, and then attacking Hiroki, his former friend, with Takashi Sasaki trying to calm Jintaro down, and Jintaro would end up getting on the mic and making a challenge to Hiroki to a match at a future date. And then Riki Fuji and Kitty Yano, they're going to team up to take on Minoru Fujita and Takuya Sugawara. Fujita and Sugawara at this point, they're an established tag team in Freedoms. They're teaming up with one another every month. In this match, Riki would end up hitting a kamikaze on Sugawara as Yano would end up climbing the top rope. And then Riki would end up sending Yano flying off the top rope onto Sugawara. Eventually, Yano would end up hitting a dropkick on Fujita and then charge at Sugawara. But he ended up missing Sugawara and ended up hitting the top rope. And then Sugawara Sugawara would end up rolling Yano up for the win. So again, this is just to establish Fujita and Sugawara as a tag team in Freedoms. And then Jun Kasai and Takashi Sasaki, they're going to team up in a handicap single elimination match against the Kajika Army, consisting of Great Kajika, the Brahmin Brothers, Ken 45, and Kazuhiko Ogasawara. And this is kind of like a gauntlet match where it starts off one-on-one, and then once you've eliminated one member of the team, then the other member comes up to face you. So it's, like I said, it's like a gauntlet single elimination match. The match would start off with Brahmin Brothers Shu and Jun Kasai fighting on the apron, and then Shu would end up grabbing a kendo stick to knock Kasai onto the floor to eliminate him, but the ref would end up seeing him use the kendo stick and not allow it, so Jun Kasai is allowed to continue the match. They would end up getting back on the apron with Kasai charging at Shu, but this time Ki would end up using the kendo stick to trip Jun Kasai, and Shu would end up trying to suplex Kasai off the apron when Ki would end up just throwing a chair at Kasai, and that would cause both Kasai and Shu to fall off the apron to the outside, so both Shu and Kasai are eliminated. So now it's going to be Takashi Sasaki as the only member of his team going up against the four members of the Kajika Army. It starts off with Sasaki taking on Ki, and they would be fighting for position when Shu would end up jumping on the apron and trying to spit Indian ink into Takashi Sasaki's face, but Sasaki would end up moving out of the way, and Ki would end up getting spit in the face instead with the Indian ink, and then Sasaki would end up laying Ki out with a kick to eliminate him as Ken 45 would rush into the ring. So next it's going to be Ken 45 taking on Takashi Sasaki. The Great Kajika would end up coming in the ring and interfering for Ken 45, but eventually Takashi Sasaki would end up sending Ken 45 over the top rope and then striking him, causing Ken 45 to fall off the apron, but he would end up falling into the arms of the entire Kajika Army outside the ring, and they would catch Ken 45 and just fling him back onto the apron. This would happen two separate times to save Ken 45. Eventually, Sasaki and Ken 45, they would get on the apron and begin fighting with one another when Ken 45 would grab the kendo stick, and as he's about to knock Sasaki off the apron, the Great Kajika would tell him to go back into the ring with Sasaki instead of eliminate him. So Ken 45 would listen and then grab a hold of Sasaki as Kajika would get in the ring and try and throw powder at Sasaki, but Sasaki would end up moving out of the way, and Kajika would end up accidentally throwing it the powder in Ken 45's eyes. As this is all going on, the referee is being distracted by Brahmin Shu, as Jun Kasai would end up climbing up the top rope and hitting a Pearl Harbor splash on Ken 45, and Sasaki would end up just tossing Ken 45 over the top rope to eliminate him. Next would be Kazuhiko Ogasawara coming in next to take on Takashi Sasaki, and Takashi Sasaki would make quick work of Ogasawara by making him tap out really quickly. This would lead to Great Kajika taking on Sasaki in the final match, and Kajika would just continue to try and roll up Takashi Sasaki over and over, trying to get the three count, but it would not work. Eventually, the Kajika Army would end up entering the ring and just all attacking Takashi Sasaki, with Jun Kasai also coming in the ring to try and help out Takashi Sasaki. Great Kajika would end up grabbing a hold of Sasaki as Ken 45 would grab the kendo stick, and as Ken 45 would try to hit Sasaki over the head with the kendo stick, Sasaki would move out of the way, and Ken 45 would actually end up hitting Great Kajika in the head with the stick instead. Sasaki would then try to finish off Kajika, but Brahmin Brother Ki would end up throwing powder in Sasaki's face, and then Brahmin Brother Shu would end up hitting Sasaki over the head with a chair, allowing the Great Kajika to pin Takashi Sasaki for the win. So Great Kajika ends up getting the win for the Kajika Army, and they're going to continue to be the number one heel stable in the promotion going into the Korakuen Hall show in June. Afterwards, Antonio Honda would end up getting on the mic and announcing that the newest member of the Kajika Army would be Tajiri, as Tajiri would end up coming into the ring, shaking everyone's hands, but then as he would end up going over to shake Kajika's hands, he would end up kicking Kajika in the head and then spitting green mist in Antonio Honda's face and running off. So this not only establishes Tajiri as a face, but also as a member of the Freedoms group, along with Takashi Sasaki and all the other faces. And then the main event's going to be Jintaro teaming up with the Winger and Kamui, and they're going to go up against Tatsuhiro Takeiwa, Masashi Takeda, and Magnitude Kishiwa, Kishiwada. In this match, Kamui would end up sending Kishiwada out of the ring, and while everyone was also outside the ring, Kamui would end up hitting an Acai moonsault onto everybody. Kamui would then end up coming off the top rope and hitting a flying dropkick on Kishiwada, but Kishiwada would come back and hit a lariat on Kamui, and then Kishiwada would tag in Takeda, who would send Kamui flying across the ring with the dropkick. Eventually, Jintaro and Takeiwa, they would end up facing off against each other, with Takeiwa suplexing Jintaro off the top rope, and then Kishiwada would end up hitting a last ride powerbomb on Jintaro, followed by Takeda hitting a spear on Jintaro, and then Jintaro would try to fight back, but he would end up being hit with a Death Valley bomb by Takeiwa, and then Takeda would end up finishing off Jintaro with a German suplex for the win, as they would continue to push Takeda as a top guy in freedoms and not needing death matches or anything like that, as just a straight wrestler. Takeda obviously has a lot of talent, and that's why Big Japan has pushed him so heavily, and now Freedoms is going to push him as well, but also kind of in a neutral, no longer as, you know, Jun Kasai's sidekick or anything like that, which he had previously been. He's now kind of on his own, or at least now with Tatsuhiro Takeiwa, like I said, who's kind of in a neutral group right now, not necessarily with the Freedoms group or with the Kajika Army. And Takeda and Takeiwa now are also an established tag team as well.
A situation would take place with Miki Ibaragi that would get him and his Shin-W ING promotion in some serious trouble on April 30th at Shinkiba. Can you go over the details that took place and what happened to the Shin-W ING promotion as a result?
So this would all start with Super Leather doing something he's probably done nearly 100 times over the last 15 years, which is travel from North Carolina to Narita. Throughout the 90s with FMW, he never had an issue. He had the proper paperwork. He went over for Kanemura's XWF promotion in 2008, and even with Tarzan Goto in 2010, back in January. And this time, though, it's going to be a lot different for Super Leather, because he ends up flying to Narita and essentially gets stopped at immigration. And what had happened was a rival promoter, I don't know who it was, but pretty much they snitched on Super Leather and said, you know, hey, this guy, he doesn't have the proper paperwork and he has a criminal past, and they, you know, you should not let him in the country. He is not legally allowed to, you know, travel. He, you know, and this is to prevent, to screw over both Shin FMW and Shin Wing. So again, I don't know who this promoter is that's doing this, but he essentially, you know, tips off that Super Leather doesn't have the proper paperwork, and that's true. What happened was Tarzan Goto didn't want to spend the money on getting a working visa. Tarzan Goto is the one bringing him over. Well, Tarzan Goto gets in contact with a guy to handle the visa paperwork, but the guy ends up not filing it correctly, and as a result, Super Leather is detained while arriving into Japan, and they end up putting him in a detention center, where he has to stay for several days. So he ends up just pretty much staying at the Narita airport for several days, not being allowed in this country. And because of the improper paperwork and the visa not being up to par to be able to be... And like I said, Super Leather had a criminal background. And so, you know, when they see a guy not having the proper paperwork to get into this country, and you have a criminal background, you know, it was okay with FMW because they put the money into the proper visa, you know, getting a working visa, and everything was up to par. Well, because of this issue, because, you know, it comes off as, ooh, you're trying to, you know, get into this country, and, you know, things have changed a lot since 1995 and, you know, the 90s and 2010 at this point. And so the fact that he has this criminal background and he's trying to, you know, illegally get into the country, that's not looked good upon him. And so he ends up, you know, like I said, having to stay in Narita for a couple days before they end up just sending him back. And so Super Leather is not able to wrestle on these upcoming shows. And the ironic part to this story is the guy that screwed up Super Leather's visa, he would end up starting his own visa application company, and he is actually the go-to guy for every foreigner wrestler trying to get into Japan. They go through his company in order to get the proper paperwork to be able to work in Japan. And so, I'm guessing him and his company has greatly improved since 2010, when they really screwed up Super Leather's paperwork, and as a result, not only was he denied entrance into Japan, and never allowed to come back. But he is Super Leather is now no longer allowed to leave the country. He was actually even denied entrance into Canada just trying to visit it a couple years ago. So this, you know, really kind of screwed up Super Leather, because, like I said, criminal background, and it looks like you're trying to be shady and trying to get into the country illegally with bad paperwork. Well, you know, Tarzan Goto didn't want to pay for the work visa, and, you know, got him with this guy, and this guy screwed up, and as a result, Super Leather is not able to work this upcoming Shin-W ING show and the Shin FMW show. The main event of the Shin-W ING show was scheduled to be Kentaro Kanemura going by the Wing name, so Wing Kanemura taking on Super Leather. Well, now Super Leather is out, and so Miki Ibaragi has to scramble. Okay, you know, and this is the first show that Super Leather is going to be in, so this has just happened. So right before the show, it's, oh crap, what are we going to do? So Miki Ibaragi has to scramble pretty much to find a replacement for Super Leather, and he contacts All Japan and works out a deal with All Japan to allow Super Crazy on the show. And Super Crazy had just worked the Junior Heavyweight Tag Team Tournament, and the day before had just won it with Bushi. So All Japan goes, okay, we're going to send you Super Crazy, but he cannot lose on this show. He can't, you know, we have to protect him. He just won our Junior Tag Team Tournament. And Miki Ibaragi has to go, sure, okay, whatever you want, you know, Super Crazy will win over Kanemura. So they would end up having the match, and this is going to be a Falls Count Anywhere match, and Super Crazy, he would end up hitting a Senton Atomico off the top rope on Kanemura. Well, Kanemura would end up falling back and hitting his head and busting open his head on the concrete outside the ring, as his head would end up smacking it really hard. So Kanemura's head is busted open, and Kanemura would end up staying down on the ground for a couple minutes as the fans would actually start to begin getting very worried. Kanemura would end up slowly getting up, and afterwards, they would end up getting back in the ring and pretty much go straight to the finish, which would be Kanemura hitting a Senton Splash for the win, to the shock of everybody. Kanemura would then end up just getting straight up and just leaving the ring. No celebration, nothing. We'd end up just going straight to the ring where an ambulance had been called to take him to the hospital. Well, Kanemura ends up refusing to go to the ambulance because he has no health insurance. And he just can't afford to pay for, you know, to be taken on this ambulance into the hospital. You know, it's been 8 years, but he still does not have insurance. He had insurance with FMW, but as far as I know, I don't think, you know, the Apache Army or even WEW or any promotion that he was running, especially now, really put that much money into paying for wrestlers' insurance. I know FMW did, but, you know, Kanemura at this point, his home promotion is XWF, which is pretty much dead. They're not going to cover his insurance. So Kanemura says, no, I can't go on, you know, I'm not going to the ambulance, and I'm not going to pay for the hospital bills and everything like that. Well, after this, All Japan ends up getting word that Kanemura defeated Super Crazy, and they send the Yakuza out to take care of Miki Ibaragi. They have felt that he has double-crossed him. As Ibaragi had promised that Crazy was going to win, but Ibaragi ends up telling them, no, Kanemura, he ended up screwing this up himself. His head, he got a head injury, which was legit, and he ended up screwing up the spot and forgetting the finish, and he just wanted the match to end, and that's what happened. You know, believe me, I'm sorry, guys, you know, I had no control of this. But the Yakuza would not buy this at all, telling Ibaragi, wait, if that's the case, then why did the referee count three? No, the referee knew also to count to three. That's bull. You know, we know you tried to double-cross All Japan. And as a result, the Yakuza would end up getting the Shin-W ING promotion closed down for good, and Miki Ibaragi now is no longer ever allowed to promote a wrestling show. And then after that, Super Crazy, he would end up no longer being booked by All Japan after the end of this tour because they felt he had agreed on the double cross by not kicking out. So when I asked Kanemura about this, you know, I brought it up in the interview and he just said, my head hurt. And I injured my head and I went, you know, he told the same story that Ibaragi told. But then I said, but what about, you know, why did the referee count three? And he just laughed and just said, I don't care. I don't care. And I feel like that kind of gave the real answer of what really happened. You know, he did really bust his head. But at the end of the day, I don't care. I'm going to do it my way. Whether Ibaragi was in on it, which I think he was, which I think the Yakuza was right to kind of not buy this excuse. I think it was, hey, who is this guy to win a main event at Wing? No, you know, we'll tell them what they want to hear, and then we'll do what we want to do afterwards. And, you know, I think Super Crazy got, you know, paid off to, you know, okay, I'll keep my shoulders down, and no one will be the wiser. And All Japan did not buy this excuse. The Yakuza didn't buy this excuse, and as a result, the Shin-W ING promotion will now no longer be in existence. This video footage never existed, but as a result, the Shin-W ING promotion that's scheduled to still hold one more show in June, they had booked a Shinkiba show, they are no longer going to be able to run that show. They closed down after this. Tarzan Goto's Shin FMW promotion, they end up taking that booking, and Shin-W ING and Miki Ibaragi, they are no longer allowed to promote ever again. And so with this Wing, as far as an actual wrestling promotion, is officially dead 16 years after the original closing of Wing.
Freedoms will run their first show at the Yokohama Red Brick Warehouse on May 2nd. Can you talk about some of the matches going on at that show?
Yeah, so the opening match on this show is going to be Koji Nakagawa making his return to Freedoms for the first time in 8 months since the debut show back in September. Like I said earlier, Freedoms had kind of grown cold on Nakagawa and stopped booking him. You know, his look just, he didn't really look like a wrestler anymore, especially, you know, his body and the loss of his hair, and it wasn't like he was necessarily a good wrestler at this point anymore. But they would book him for this show, and this would actually be his last show for 7 years after this. But Nakagawa would end up teaming up with Ricky Fuji and the Winger on this show, and they would go up against the Brahmin Brothers and Antonio Honda. In this match, the Brahmin Brothers would end up triple teaming Nakagawa with Honda, but eventually Nakagawa would end up catching one of the Brahmin Brothers' kicks and be able to make the hot tag to Ricky. The Brahmin Brothers would end up getting Ricky in the corner and begin pouring water all over his head, and then the Brahmin Brothers would end up throwing Ricky into the ropes, but Ricky would end up coming back with a double clothesline to both of them, and then hit Honda with a brainbuster. The Winger would end up getting tagged in to go up against the Brahmin Brothers, but the Brahmin Brothers would try to suplex the Winger until Nakagawa would come in to try and even things out before Honda and Ricky would end up also coming in, and so there's this 3-on-3 battle to try and suplex with one another, with the babyface side getting the win by managing to suplex the Brahmin Brothers and Honda. Nakagawa would eventually end up getting triple teamed by the Brahmin Brothers and Honda, but Key would end up grabbing a hold of Nakagawa as Shu would end up spitting Indian ink, with Nakagawa moving out of the way, and Shu would end up accidentally spitting the ink into Key's face as Ricky would end up hitting a kamikaze, and then Nakagawa would end up doing a jackknife roll-up on Key for the win. So Nakagawa gets a win. Like I said, this was his last show for Freedoms for the next 7 years, so he ends up getting a win on the way out. Then the next match is Magnitude Kishiwada teaming up with Shadow WX. They're going to take on Madaka and Kamui. Kishiwada would end up sending Madaka in the air, but Madaka would manage to hit this impressive-looking Hurricane Rana and send him outside the ring, as Madaka and Kamui would both hit Acai moonsaults onto WX and Magnitude. Madaka would then bring Kishiwada into the ring, and Madaka would end up hitting a flying dropkick on Kishiwada, but then Kishiwada would end up sending Madaka flying into the air when kicking out. Madaka and Kamui would then work together on Shadow WX and place a board over him, as Madaka would end up hitting a swanton bomb, followed by Kamui hitting a moonsault onto Shadow WX. Shadow WX would end up grabbing Kamui and giving him this nasty-looking sideways powerbomb through the board, and then Kishiwada would end up hitting a fire thunder on Kamui on a set of chairs, and then hit him with the last ride powerbomb for the win. So Magnitude Kishiwada and Shadow WX, they're bigger, they have more experience, they're more established, they're gonna get the wins over these young, you know, junior heavyweights every time. And then the next match is Great Kajika taking on Tajiri. This feud has been built up since the very first Freedom show back in September of 2009, when Kajika was a face and Tajiri was a heel. Well, now the roles have been reversed, and Tajiri is a face and Kajika is the main heel. In this match, Tajiri would end up taking Kajika around the building before hitting him with a water bottle in the crowd, before Tajiri would throw Kajika back in the ring. Out of nowhere, Onryo would randomly show up outside the ring. And while Tajiri is just looking at Onryo, stunned that he would just randomly show up like that, Kajika would take advantage and begin choking Tajiri. Kajika would end up throwing Tajiri into the ropes, and Tajiri would end up coming back and hitting a shoulder tackle on Kajika, as both wrestlers would end up just laying in the ring dead, when Onryo would end up coming into the ring and throw dust in the referee's face, and then Onryo would go after Tajiri and allow all the Kajika army to attack Tajiri. So Onryo is joining with the Kajika army here. Tajiri would begin to fight back and hit a handspring elbow on Antonio Honda and Abdullah Kobayashi, but as he was about to go after Kajika, Onryo would turn him around and throw powder in Tajiri's face, and then Kajika would put the claw on Tajiri, but Tajiri would come back and spit green mist into Kajika's face while the claw was applied to him, and then Tajiri would end up laying Kajika out with a buzzsaw kick and end up picking up the win over Great Kajika. And then afterwards, the Kajika army would all come out and begin yelling at one another, but by the end of it, they would end up all making up and hugging one another, including getting Onryo involved in the group hug, as they would declare war on the Freedom's Army for the very first Freedom show at Korakuen Hall in June. The semi-main event would be Jintaro taking on Hiroki. This was set up the month prior when Jintaro attacked Hiroki after the Takashi Sasaki match. And in this match, Jintaro would end up hitting a leg drop and then follow that up with a flying elbow drop, which would bust open Hiroki's nose. His elbow would connect Hiroki's nose hard, and so Hiroki is bleeding from the nose after this. Hiroki would end up trying to come back by hitting a trance rave kick, but Jintaro would end up grabbing Hiroki's leg and putting him in a leg lock, with Hiroki tapping out immediately. Afterwards, Jintaro and Hiroki would shake hands, as Hiroki has re-earned Jintaro's respect, so they're cool now. They're both going to be a part of the Freedoms group. No issues anymore between the two. And then the main event is going to be Takashi Sasaki and Jun Kasai taking on Tatsuhiro Takeiwa and Masashi Takeda. In this match, Takeda and Kasai, they would begin exchanging strikes with one another, with Takeda going for a spear, but Kasai would move out of the way, and then Kasai would end up delivering a German suplex to Takeda. And then Takashi Sasaki and Tatsuhiro Takeiwa would square off, with Takeiwa hitting a Death Valley bomb, followed by Takeda hitting a German suplex on Sasaki, with Kasai having to make the save for Sasaki. Takeda would then go for a spear, but he would be met with a kick to the face by Sasaki, followed by a charging lariat, and then a powerbomb, and then finally Takashi Sasaki would put Takeda away with a D-Geist for the win. So again, you know, Takeda is getting pushed, but he's still not at that level of, you know, the Takashi Sasaki and the Jintaros that have 10 plus years experience at this point, whereas Takeda still only has just a couple years experience at this point. But, you know, they know Takeda has the potential to be a top star in the promotion. He's just not there yet. So overall, this show was just kind of a bigger show than the regular Shinkiba shows, but it was there still to build up the upcoming Freedom show at Korakuen Hall the following month.
Big Japan would hold their 15th anniversary show on May 4th at the Yokohama Bunka Gym. Can you go over some of the matches on that show?
Yeah, so since this is the 15th anniversary of Big Japan, they would bring in some old acts from previous years of the promotion, and that would include CCW. So they're going to bring in DJ Hyde and Nick Gage that are currently working for CCW. This has nothing to do with Zandig and, you know, his CCW that he was running with Big Japan 10 years earlier. They're going to team up with Jun Kasai, and they're all going to take on Jackie Numazawa, Sami Kodaka, and Masashi Takeda in a Razor Cross barbed wire board death match. Kasai and Numazawa, they would start off in the ring teasing spots of going into the barbed wire board as well as the razor cross board, before they would end up brawling outside the ring, with Nick Gage and Takeda getting in the ring, with Gage throwing Takeda into the barbed wire board. While that's going on, Kasai and Numazawa, they would end up brawling onto the stage of the Yokohama Bunka Gym, with Kasai pile driving Numazawa. Gage would end up putting a CCW shirt over Kodaka's head and begin the shirt to Kadaka's head, and then Kasai would end up coming in the ring and setting up the razor cross board on a set of chairs and trying to suplex Numazawa off the top, but Numazawa would manage to escape and try to powerbomb Kasai, but Kasai would manage to block it and then suplex Numazawa onto the razor cross board. Takeda would then end up coming in and hitting a German suplex on Kasai on the razor cross board, with Gage and Hyde throwing Takeda into the ropes, but Takeda would end up hitting a powerful spear on Gage. Takeda would then end up putting a barbed wire board over Gage and then suplexing Hyde off the top turnbuckle, sending Hyde through the barbed wire board, laying over Gage, with Kodaka coming off the top and delivering a knee drop through the barbed wire board. Eventually, Kasai would end up going at it against Kodaka and hitting a reverse Tiger Driver on him, followed by DJ Hyde hitting a clothesline, and then Gage would end up delivering a pile driver, and then Kasai would end up putting the Razor Cross board and hitting a Pearl Harbor splash on Kodaka to get the win. So Kasai, DJ Hyde, and Nick Gage end up getting the win. So CZW once again defeats Big Japan here, bringing back some nostalgia, I'm sure, for Big Japan. And then the main event of the show is going to be Yuko Miyamoto defending the Big Japan Deathmatch heavyweight title in a fluorescent light tubes cage deathmatch. They would start off by fighting on top of the cage, with Miyamoto knocking Ito off the cage and then diving off the top with a crossbody onto Ito. They would end up fighting on top of the turnbuckle, with Ito suplexing Miyamoto off through a table, and then they would eventually end up taking turns hitting each other over the head with light tubes before Ito would end up picking up Miyamoto and hitting a fire thunder. So Ito hits Miyamoto with his own move. Then Ito would end up placing Miyamoto on a table and begin climbing up to the top, but Miyamoto would get up and hit Ito with a light tube and then hit Ito with a fire thunder off the top rope through the table. Miyamoto would then place some light tubes over Ito's body and hit a moonsault off the top, breaking light tubes across Ito's body, and then pick up Ito and hit a fire thunder on a stack of light tubes before climbing up to the top of the cage and hitting a moonsault off the top of the cage onto Ito. Miyamoto would then try to send Ito into the light tubes tied to the ropes, but Ito would end up reversing it and sending Miyamoto into it instead, and then Ito would end up hitting a German suplex on Miyamoto and then climb up to the top of the cage and hit a dragon splash off the cage for the win. So Ito now has won back his Big Japan Deathmatch Championship. This ends Yuko Miyamoto's 16-plus month reign as champion. You know, like I've talked about last episode, even though Miyamoto was champion, Ryuji Ito is still the ace of the promotion. He's still the face of what they're doing. And so the biggest show of the year for Big Japan, he's going to win the championship. And this was an okay match. It was nothing compared to what some of the matches Miyamoto was doing in 2009, and that's just kind of what Big Japan overall, you know, they're good matches, but there's nothing really special going on, especially compared to what they were doing in 2009, where it was just great match after great match after great match. These are kind of, they're kind of doing the same formula with the same guys, but these matches aren't really clicking, and this is a perfect example. This match didn't really necessarily click. I mean, you had Miyamoto doing some really cool, awesome spots, including doing a moonsault off a cage, but still, it was nothing really special. It's still nothing you have to go see or anything like that, especially after what they were doing last year, month after month after month.
Atsushi Onita would have another retirement match on May 5th in Shinkiba for Tarzan Goto's Shin FMW promotion. Can you talk about the match he was in and why Onita was going to retire again?
So this is going to be the 15-year anniversary of Onita retiring in FMW at Kawasaki Stadium against Hayabusa, and 15 years later, he's going to be retiring again. The original plan was for Onita to retire in January, but he pushed it back to March, and then it got pushed back again, and here you have it. He's 15 years later, he's retiring, and he's going to team up with Tarzan Goto for this Shin FMW show. They announced 327 fans, which, you think about it, 15 years earlier, Onita's retiring at Kawasaki Stadium in a sold out, you know, baseball stadium, and 15 years later, his retirement can't sell out Shinkiba. But, you know, obviously, I don't think too many people bought that this was going to be the real retirement for Onita. They're going to team up to take on the Great Punk, who is Kazutoshi Niyama, and he's going to team up with the Shooter, who is Benji Takada. Niyama had worked FMW in the early days up until 97 when he left to join up with Tarzan Goto due to his loyalty with Tarzan Goto. And Benji Takada had worked FMW very briefly in 2001. I've never seen highlights or anything. I don't know if any footage of this show even exists. I haven't seen anything. Onita would end up pinning the Shooter with a Thunderfire Powerbomb for the win, and then afterwards he would end up getting on the mic talking about you know, retiring 15 years to the day previously with, you know, the May 5th 1995 show. But Onita would tell the fans that he would like to come back and wrestle again. He just doesn't know when, because right now he just doesn't have the time to wrestle, at least get in ring shape and wrestle and everything. everything. So that's why he's retiring again. So this is one of those Onita retirements that, you know, count for, you know, oh, Onita's retired so many times. But here you have Onita pretty much telling the fans after this retirement match, I'm coming back. I just don't know when because I'm just so busy right now. Goto would end up getting on the mic afterwards and then stating that he would like to wrestle Onita again when he comes back, as Onita would end up pouring water on Goto all over Goto's head for what would actually end up being the final time that they would end up sharing a ring, as they would actually end up never teaming up again. Goto would never get this match with Onita. They would, you know, have... They would definitely end up going in different directions after this show. Goto would then end up announcing that his FMW team would be invading the upcoming Shin-W ING show on June 26th. But like I talked about, you know, that show would end up never existing because of Miki Ibaragi and what everything that had happened. So Shin FMW would actually just end up taking the booking. But so the plan was originally for Shin-W ING and Shin FMW to work together after this show. But like I said, that obviously never ended up happening, because of the whole super crazy Kanemura incident.
Kanemura would return to 0-1 on May 5th at Korakuen Hall to take on Hartley Jackson in a strap death match. Can you go over this match?
Yeah, so I talked about earlier how Kanemura had become somewhat of a regular, at least for 0-1 Korakuen Hall shows, the bigger shows. And so here he's going to fight Hartley Jackson, who's an Australian wrestler that 0-1 had just began bringing in. They're going to have a strap death match. Before the match would even begin, you see Necro Butcher, Nick Gage in the crowd just watching this match. So they would start off brawling to the outside with Kanemura throwing Jackson into the crowd, but Jackson would end up coming back and sending Kanemura into a bunch of empty seats. They would end up fighting in the crowd with Kanemura grabbing a fan's drink and spitting it into Jackson's face. They would make it back around ringside with Kanemura putting Jackson on the table and climbing up to the top turnbuckle, but Jackson would end up getting up and using the strap to send Kanemura flying off the turnbuckle, and Kanemura would end up going through the table instead on the outside. And then Jackson would deliver a suplex to Kanemura through a stack of chairs and then throw Kanemura over the top rope and try to choke him out. But Kanemura would fight back and begin using the strap to pull Jackson to him to begin striking him, and then would end up picking up a piece of the broken table and begin smashing it over Jackson's head, and then would end up setting up two tables with Kanemura suplexing Jackson off of one table through the other. Kanemura would then end up hitting a senton splash, but as he would go for another, Jackson would end up using the strap to push him off the top, and then Jackson would begin wrapping the strap around Kanemura's neck, and then hit a Death Valley bomb, and then hit him with a lariat. But as he would go for another lariat, Kanemura would end up rolling up Jackson for the win out of nowhere. So this overall was a good match. Jackson pretty much had control a majority of the match, but you know, Kanemura has more seniority, at least, you know, in more respect with 0-1 at the time, so they're going to give him the win. You know, even though, like I said, Jackson had a majority of the offense here. But like I said, a good match overall, but the main thing missing really was the 0-1 crowd heat. The fans didn't really care. 0-1's in a bad spot right now. In 2010, that pretty much is going to continue for the most of the decade. But, you know, overall, like I said, good match, just crowd, the crowd heat was just completely lacking for this match.
Freedoms would run at Shinkiba on May 26th, where they would announce the main event matches for the upcoming Korakuen Hall show. Can you go over some of the top matches on the show?
Yeah, so they would announce 234 fans for this show. So pretty much the standard Shinkiba show at this point. You know, it's pretty much the same loyal fan base coming to every month to the Shinkiba shows. And on this show, Tajiri and Riki Fuji, they team up to take on the Kajika Army members, Onryo and Antonio Honda. Riki would end up picking up Honda and delivering a kamikaze to him, and then tag in Tajiri, who would hit a handspring elbow onto Honda, and then Honda would end up grabbing a hold of Tajiri as Onryo would end up throwing powder, but Tajiri would end up moving out of the way, and so Onryo would hit Honda in the face with the powder, and then Onryo would charge at Tajiri, who would leapfrog him, with Onryo running into Honda instead, and then Tajiri would try to spit green mist into Onryo's face, but Onryo would move out of the way, and Tajiri would end up spitting the mist into Honda's face instead, and then Tajiri would end up rolling up Honda with a schoolboy for the win. And then Hiroki would end up taking on Tomohiro Ishii. Ishii's the one that originally injured Hiroki 2.5 years earlier by dropping him on his head accidentally. And so Hiroki is getting this match for his revenge. Hiroki would end up going after Ishii right away and then send him out of the ring. And Hiroki would end up hitting a tope on Ishii, which would send him into the crowd. And then Hiroki would begin using a chair on Ishii, and they would begin brawling in the crowd. But eventually Ishii would end up throwing Hiroki into the seats. And then Ishii would begin working on Hiroki's lower back, which is where he had suffered the lower spine injury. And then eventually Hiroki would come back with chops, but Ishii would just chop him right back, which would knock Hiroki down to the mat. And then Ishii would begin working on Hiroki's lower back once again by putting him in a camel clutch, with Hiroki having to fight out of the move. And eventually Hiroki would end up hitting a trance rave kick on Ishii, and then charge at Ishii with the lariat, but Ishii would end up hitting him with the lariat instead. And then Ishii would end up hitting a powerbomb and follow that up with a lariat to get the win over Hiroki. So Hiroki ends up not getting the win over Ishii. Hiroki's just not at the status of Ishii to be able to get a win over him in a singles match. And, you know, that's just how the Japanese do it. Ishii is a bigger star, has more experience. Even if it makes for a better story that Hiroki get the revenge win over Ishii, that's just not how it's done in Japan, and Ishii ends up getting the win, and they actually would never have another singles match between the two after this. And then the main event is Takashi Sasaki, Jun Kasai, and Kamui taking on Brahmin Key, and Magnitude Kishiwada, and they would have Great Kajika in their corner, and it would be a standard beginning to a Freedom's main event where all six would end up brawling all over the building. Kajika would end up pulling out his siren and putting it right next to Sasaki's ear and begin blaring it right into Sasaki's ear. And then eventually Kajika would end up putting a trash can over Sasaki. Eventually they would end up getting in the ring where all the Kajika army members, the Brahmin brothers, Onryo, Antonio Honda, Ken 45, they would all end up hitting a drop kick to Kamui together. And then eventually Kamui would end up having to tag in Kasai, who would clear the ring and lay out the Brahmin brothers with a lariat and then a reverse tiger driver before he would end up hitting a Pearl Harbor splash. But Ken 45 would end up grabbing the referee and pulling him out of the ring before he could make the three count. Then the Brahmin brothers would end up spitting Indian ink in Kasai's face, and Kasai would end up having to tag in Sasaki, who would begin exchanging lariats with the Magnitude Kishiwada until Sasaki would end up being the one to knock Kishiwada down. The entire Kajika army would then rush into the ring and go after Sasaki, with Kishiwada putting Sasaki away with the last ride powerbomb for the win. So the Kajika army get the win over the Freedom's army right before the big Korakuen Hall show on the following month. Afterwards, they would announce that the main event is going to be a 3 out of 5, or best 3 out of 5 singles matches between the Kajika army and the Freedom's army, where they would all end up announcing members to their team and the matches that are going to happen in the 5 versus 5 match, with the Kajika army making the big announcement that they're going to have the Great Sasuke on their team. And so the Great Sasuke is going to take on Takashi Sasaki in one of the marquee matches on the show. And this would upset the Brahmin brothers and Ken 45 when they hear this, because they've been feuding with the Great Sasuke and Michinoku Pro for the last 5 years or so. So they have been bitter rivals with Sasuke for the longest time, and they are not happy that the Sasuke is going to be representing the Great Kajika Army at the Korakuen Hall show next month.
Freedoms would hold their first Korakuen Hall show on June 21st. Can you talk about how this show did and what took place?
So they would announce a crowd of 1,193 fans for this show, which is a huge success for Freedoms. You know, this is going to be like their big WrestleMania of the year. I was at this show live, and people were talking like this show was going to be the lowest attended Korakuen Hall show ever because of how small Freedoms was. And, you know, here they are running Korakuen Hall. And I remember being, there's over 1,000 people here. So if this number isn't real, it's very close to being real, because I definitely just looking at how many people were in the crowd, and in comparison, there was definitely over 1,000 people there that night. This show would also be the debut of the new Red Ring that the Freedoms promotion had just recently purchased. The first 9 months of the promotion, they had either been using another promotion's ring or using the ring that just comes with Shinkiba. The opening match on this show is going to be Kamui, Riki Fuji, Shinobu, Madaka, and Kiri Yano taking on Abdullah Kobayashi, Kazuhiko Ogasawara, Brahmin Shu, and Brahmin Key, as well as Kin 45 in a Captain's Falls elimination match. So Kamui and Kobayashi, they're going to be the captains of this match. So if one of them gets eliminated or out of the match, then the whole team is out. The Kajika Army, they would end up going after Kamui right away. They'd jump him and throw him over the top rope. But the referee would not allow this, so they're all excited thinking they've won the match. But the referee says, nope, you jumped them before the bell rang. This doesn't count. This would pretty much be a typical Survivor Series from the 1980s match, where a bunch of moves that don't usually put someone away now actually put the wrestler away. So Riki Fuji, he ends up hitting a kamikaze on Brahmin Key to eliminate him. Eventually, Riki and Brahmin Shu, they would end up brawling on the apron, with Kobayashi drop kicking them both, and they would both end up falling to the floor to be eliminated. So both Brahmin brothers are now out, as well as Riki Fuji. Kobayashi would end up dropping an elbow on Kiri Yano to eliminate him. And then Shinobu, he would end up climbing up to the top rope. But one of the Brahmin brothers, despite being eliminated, would end up knocking him off to eliminate him. So Shinobu's now out. Madaka, then he would end up going at it with Ken 45 and would jump up on the apron. And as he's going to go to jump onto the rope, with the ref distracted by Ken 45, one of the Brahmin brothers would end up knocking him off the apron to eliminate him. So this now leaves Kamui to take on three members of the Kujika Army: Abdullah Kobayashi, Kazuhiko Ogasawara, and Ken 45. All five of the Kujika Army members, they would end up hitting the ring. Kobayashi, he would end up going for a super power bomb, but Kamui would end up turning it into a Hurricane Rana. Ogasawara would end up grabbing a hold of Kamui as Kobayashi would go to chop him in the head, but Kamui would manage to move out of the way, and Kobayashi would accidentally hit Ogasawara in the head instead, and then Kamui would end up rolling up Kobayashi for the win. So despite being 1-on-3, Kamui ends up winning the match for his team by eliminating the captain, Abdullah Kobayashi, in the match. And then Mama Sasaki, he's going to return to the ring for the first time in 16 months, and he's going to have a singles match against Daisuke Sekimoto. He had a rivalry with Sekimoto the last 4 years or so. You know, they had some great matches with one another, and they were actually tag partners right before Mammoth got hurt, before he got in his car accident. So Mammoth chooses to have this match against Sekimoto, also knowing that he's going to have a match against a great wrestler like Sekimoto. And like I said, I was here for this show, and the start of this match is electric. The crowd is pumped for this. They are happy to see Mammoth return back into the ring, and they would start off by charging at each other right away. And like I said, you could just feel the electricity in the crowd with how awesome the crowd is, and they're just pumped to see Mammoth and Sekimoto go at it with one another. They would end up exchanging chops with one another and then clotheslining one another, and then Sekimoto, he would end up hitting Mammoth with a lariat, but Mammoth would end up getting up right away and hitting a lariat on Sekimoto, and then Mammoth would end up throwing Sekimoto out of the ring, and Mammoth would end up hitting a running lariat off the apron to the outside to a huge pop. Like I said, the crowd is pumped to see Mammoth back in the ring. Sekimoto would try to slow things down by taking it to the mat, and then Mammoth would end up grabbing Sekimoto and hitting him with the power bomb as the fans are chanting Mammoth's name out loud. They are chanting loudly for Mammoth. Mammoth would end up going for a 29 years old, but Sekimoto would manage to escape and hit a clothesline to the back of Mammoth's injured back, and then Sekimoto would end up hitting a German suplex for two. Riki Fuji would end up coming to the ringside area, and he would just begin pounding the mat, screaming for Mammoth, as Mammoth would end up kicking Sekimoto in the face and then hitting a 29 years old with Sekimoto kicking out at two. They would end up exchanging lariats with one another once again, with Sekimoto getting the better of it by knocking Mammoth down before Sekimoto would end up hitting another lariat on Mammoth for the win. So Sekimoto gets the win over Mammoth. So being there live, I thought this match was amazing. You know, being in the crowd, seeing Mammoth's return, the crowd, how hot they were, I just thought this match was an incredible experience to see. Watching it back on tape years later, I can't necessarily say it's this amazing match. It's probably one of the lower end of the Mammoth and Sekimoto matches, just because it's a short match. There's still some dragging involved, even though it is a short match. You know, it's still cool to have been there live to see Mammoth's return, but overall, I mean, watching it on tape, they're definitely better Sekimoto and Mammoth matches, even though I would still say this is a good match overall. And then there's going to be a hardcore match on the show between Jun Kasai and Necro Butcher, and I've talked about it before. Freedoms does not do death matches, so this is not promoted as a death match. It's promoted as a hardcore match. So there's a bunch of ladders as weapons used, but there's nothing sharp or anything like that, because Freedoms, you know, that's only for Jun Kasai promoted shows. It's not for Freedom shows. Freedoms does not do death matches, so this is just a hardcore match with just ladders involved. So to start this match, Kasai and Necro, they would end up climbing up a ladder and begin punching each other in the face, and then Necro would end up punching Kasai off the ladder, with Kasai landing on the turnbuckle, and then Kasai would end up drop kicking the ladder, knocking Necro off the ladder. Necro Butcher would end up taking Kasai into the crowd and hitting a sunset flip onto Kasai on the floor of the in the crowd at Korakuen Hall. Kasai would end up grabbing Necro and end up running across Korakuen Hall and throughout the entire crowd before throwing Necro into the wall of the other side of Korakuen. They would end up getting back around ringside, where Kasai would end up laying Necro Butcher on a table, and Kasai would end up climbing up a ladder in the ring and diving off the ladder, sending Necro Butcher through the table. They would eventually end up getting back in the ring with Necro Butcher hitting a powerbomb on Kasai onto a table placed on the turnbuckle. Necro would end up placing a plastic bag over Kasai's head and begin laying him down on a chair and then climb up to the top rope. But Kasai would end up throwing the bag off and then throwing Necro Butcher off the top rope onto a chair. Kasai would then end up hitting Necro Butcher over the head with two chairs and then suplexing him, followed by hitting a Pearl Harbor splash. Kasai would then end up pulling out a razor cross board, but when he would end up climbing up the top rope, Necro Butcher would end up hitting a power bomb onto him on the razor cross board. So now this is it's gone into deathmatch territory now with a sharp object like the razor cross board, but this wasn't promoted as a deathmatch. Kasai would then end up coming back with a German suplex on the ladder with Necro Butcher's head hitting the ladder in a nasty looking spot, followed by Kasai hitting a reverse tiger driver on the razor cross board, and then Kasai would end up hitting a Pearl Harbor splash off the ladder for the win. And so Kasai gets the win over Necro Butchers. Overall, this match is a good match. Kasai, over the years, would top himself so much that this match is nothing in comparison. But, I mean, overall, just, you know, the head spots, you know, Necro Butcher landing his head, hitting his head against the ladder. You know, there's still some really nasty looking spots. But overall, you know, the fact that they really couldn't go deathmatch route until the very end with just one, you know, with a razor cross board, you know, still hinders the match, especially in comparison to years later, where they are using all types of weapons in a Freedoms ring. And then the main event is going to be a best 3 out of 5 singles match between the Kajika Army and the Freedoms Army. The first match is going to be Hiroki taking on Magnitude Kishiwada. Hiroki would end up going after Kishiwada with a dropkick and then delivering a tope to Kishiwada, but Kishiwada would end up sending Hiroki into the crowd. Kishiwada would then end up getting back in the ring and trying for a powerbomb, but Hiroki would end up turning it into a Hurricane Rana for a 2 count, but then Kishiwada would end up coming back with a lariat and then follow that up with hitting a last ride powerbomb to get the win over Hiroki. So the Kajika Army start off with getting the first win, so it's 1-0, the Kajika Army. And then the next match is going to be the Winger taking on Antonio Honda. The Winger would end up trying to slam Honda, but Honda would end up rolling him up for a cradle almost instantly. This match barely even gets started when Honda ends up getting the win over the Winger. So now it is 2-0 the Kajika Army over the Freedoms Army. The next match is going to be Tajiri taking on Onryo. Onryo would end up bringing in a bamboo stick to the ring, but Tajiri would end up grabbing it away from him, and as Tajiri is about to use it, the referee would try to stop Tajiri from him using it, and that would allow Onryo to grab it and smash it over Tajiri's head. Tajiri then would end up coming back and laying Onryo out with a buzzsaw kick, and then making the cover with Onryo grabbing the referee's arm in an Onryo signature spot. Onryo would then throw powder into Tajiri's face, but as he would end up going for an Onryo clutch, he would be met by Tajiri spitting green mist into his face, and then Tajiri would end up rolling up Onryo with a Samson clutch for the win. So Tajiri defeats Onryo, and now it is 2-1 the Kajika Army over the Freedoms Army. And then the next match is going to be Takashi Sasaki taking on the great Sasuke. So Sasuke here is a member of the Kajika Army, so he has all the Kajika Army members around ringside with him, as he early on gets sick of hearing it from Ken 45 and the Brahmin Brothers, as they're just talking smack to him the entire time from the start of the match. And Sasuke would end up going outside the ring and just smacking Ken 45 in the face, and then begin chopping the Brahmin Brothers, as Antonio Honda and the rest of the Kajika Army would try to play peacemakers. They need Sasuke, no more infighting, we need Sasuke to win this match. Sasuke would end up getting back in the ring with Takashi Sasaki, bringing Sasuke into the corner and trying to hit a tornado DDT, but Takashi Sasaki would completely botch this spot. It would be an ugly looking spot with Sasuke landing awkwardly. After that, then you have Sasuke sending Takashi Sasaki out of the ring, and Sasuke would end up climbing up to the top and diving off the top to the outside, but he would barely connect with Takashi Sasaki and mostly just hit the floor in a painful looking spot. But now you have back-to-back bad-looking botched spots here. Sasuke would end up bringing in Takashi Sasaki back in the ring, and he would end up going up to the top to try and finish off Takashi Sasaki. But the Brahmin Brothers would continue yelling at Sasuke, distracting him and allowing Takashi Sasaki to get on the turnbuckle. When the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45, they would end up coming in the ring and getting Takashi Sasaki and on Ken 45's shoulders, as Sasuke would end up diving off the top, but Takashi Sasaki would manage to get off Ken 45's shoulders just in the nick of time, as Sasuke would end up diving onto the Brahmin Brothers. Takashi Sasaki would then lay Sasuke out with a kick to the head to get the win in this very disappointing match. It would only go 7 minutes, and like I said, there was two key botched spots here, so nothing really to see here, even though, Sasuke is known as a great amazing worker, actually, overall. And Takashi Sasaki, over the last couple years, has built up a reputation as a good worker, a really good worker. But this match was a total disappointment. But Takashi Sasaki gets the win, and now the Freedom's Army has tied up the Kajika Army 2-2, leading to the final match between the great Kajika and Jintaro. Jintaro, he would end up getting Kajika to the outside and hit an Acai moonsault onto him, but the Brahmin Brothers would end up throwing Jintaro back in the ring and begin smashing Jintaro's knee with the chair, and then Kajika would begin working on Jintaro's knee. Kajika would end up doing a dragon screw leg whip to Jintaro, which would really impress the crowd. They were not expecting Kajika to pull that move out. The entire Kajika army, they would end up coming out and attacking Jintaro, including Manitou Kishiwada hitting a powerbomb on Jintaro. Kajika would then end up making the cover, and the great Sasuke would end up hitting the ring, but he would actually be late to make the save for Jintaro, so Jintaro would actually have to kick out himself as another screwed up spot involving the great Sasuke happens. Sasuke would then begin stomping at Kajika, and then attack Ken 45 and the Brahmin Brothers, and then Sasuke would end up hitting a dropkick on the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45, sending them into the crowd. Kajika and Jintaro, they would begin going at it one-on-one, with Kajika trying to put the claw onto Jintaro, but Jintaro would end up rolling up Kajika and putting Kajika in the sharpshooter for Kajika to tap out, and Jintaro gets the win, so the Freedom's Army gets the win over the Kajika Army. Afterwards, Jintaro would end up hugging Kajika, and then end up putting Kajika on his back and carrying him out, as the rest of the Freedom's team would celebrate the win over the Kajika Army. So overall, this was a big success for Freedoms. The fact that they drew over 1,000 fans was a huge accomplishment for the promotion at this time, considering how small they were. There were some hits and there were some misses, definitely, with this show. The Takashi Sasaki Great Sasuke match was a total miss. But overall, this was a very good show. And like I said, this was a big accomplishment for Freedoms. They actually would not run another Korakuen Hall show for another 18 months. So they know at this point that they are not at the level where they can run Korakuen Hall regularly. It needs to be a special event like this show.
Tarzan Goto would change the name of his promotion to Super FMW on June 26th. Can you go over some of the matches on that show?
So I wanted to tell some stories real quick, just about attending the show and just kind of where I was at this time period. So, I go to the show and there's about 100 fans in the building overall. I forget what they announced, but there was about 100 people actually in the building. But a bunch of them would come in about 2 hours into the show, which looking back, they knew what was up. They knew what to do because this undercard, my goodness, it is the worst undercard I've ever been to. So, first off, the first couple matches, they're indie matches. It's fine, whatever. Nothing good, but nothing, horrible or anything like that. But then, after the second match, there's a 15-minute intermission, which, okay, that's pretty early for a show to have an intermission. Then after the intermission, a wrestler comes out for their match, one of the transvestite wrestlers. She comes out and then stands in the ring for over 8 minutes with nothing happening. The lights go off as she's just standing in the ring for this amount of time. The building's just dark. Nothing is happening. Time just froze where the lights are off. This wrestler is just in the ring. Nothing is happening. Nothing has happened essentially for over 20 minutes now between the intermission and this wrestler just coming to the ring. The lights are off, and you have to realize I am sleep deprived at this point. 5-6 nights in a row of about 3 hours of sleep. Not handling the fact that the sun is coming up at 4 a.m. every morning. Not handling it very well and waking up and not getting back to sleep. So I am completely sleep deprived. I am struggling so hard to stay awake as you've just turn the lights off that I was going insane at this point with how little sleep. Like, I remember being very upset. This is probably the worst. I mean, I've went to Japan 8 times and I've never been so sleep deprived on any trip before or after. So you add in the fact that nothing is happening for 20 plus minutes on this boring show and now you've darkened the arena. I'm not handling this very well at all. So anyway, there's a match between Riki Fuji and Rina Ayukawa. As if you're watching this on YouTube, as you can see, this is not a good match whatsoever. Riki is trying to carry her, and that's not a good sign. It's just bad. It's not horrible or anything, but just everything on this show just before the main event was just death. It's just something that I will never forget. And Riki would end up defeating Reina Ayukawa in their match. With all that said, the main event was an awesome experience live. You had Mr. Pogo, Tarzan Goto, Masahiro Sase, and Yuta Nakata taking on Jun Kasai, Shadow WX, The Winger, and Nobuhiro Tsurumaki, who is a old-time Wing wrestler from like the early first year of Wing. So it's kind of like this Big Japan Wing group going up against the FMW team. Kasai would end up hitting a Pearl Harbor Splash, but Goto would end up smashing Kasai's back with a chair, and then Goto would then pick up a stack of chairs in the ring and hit a powerbomb on a massive Winger, followed by clotheslining him for the win. There's not too much of a highlights that were shown here, but like I said, this was an awesome match live. Just being in the crowd, the wrestlers brawling all right next to you, chairs getting thrown right in front of you. It is an awesome experience live, which I've said in the past, like, I'm sure it didn't make tape very well if you did watch this on tape, but overall the match experience live was awesome. Afterwards, Goto and Pogo, they would end up shaking hands as they agreed to continue to team up. So this just where the promotion's gonna be, and going forward they're gonna be the two top wrestlers of the promotion. But I'll go over here in a minute, this promotion's about to get even uglier and fast.
Big Japan would run at Korakuen Hall on June 27th. Can you go over some of the noteworthy events that took place?
Yeah, so I was at this show as well, and it was a really entertaining match with Yuko Miyamoto teaming up with Necro Butcher, taking on Shuji Ishikawa and Kenkoro Hoshino. And in this match, Ishikawa and Necro Butcher, they would end up doing a dueling chair spot, but just as Necro Butcher was about to hit Ishikawa with the chair, Ishikawa would tell Necro Butcher to look the other way, and despite Necro Butcher originally not falling for it, eventually he would end up falling for it and looking the other way, and Ishikawa would end up hitting him in the back with the chair. Eventually, Ishikawa and Necro Butcher, they would end up brawling in the crowd of Korakuen, with Miyamoto and Hoshino eventually meeting up with them, and Miyamoto would end up climbing up the entrance ramp at Korakuen and doing a moonsault onto everybody in the crowd. And then they would end up all brawling to the other side of Korakuen, as Necro Butcher would end up going up to the balcony of Korakuen, and Necro Butcher would pretty much just end up dropping himself off the balcony onto all three wrestlers. This is the only time that I would ever personally get to see somebody dive off the balcony at Korakuen Hall, and it's probably the worst worst balcony dive you'll ever see is, like I said, Necro Butcher pretty much just drops himself onto everybody, but it's still cool to at least have seen somebody do that live. Miyamoto and Hoshino, they would end up making it back in the ring, but Ishikawa would end up coming in and dumping Miyamoto to the outside on a set of stacked chairs. Necro Butcher, his knee is killing him after that balcony dive, and he would not be able to leave the stage area of Korakuen, which would result in Miyamoto having to fend for himself against Ishikawa and Hoshino, until Ishikawa and Hoshino would try to suplex Miyamoto, with Necro Butcher making it back in the ring with the chair, and he would end up using it on both of them, and then Hoshino would end up putting the chair around Necro's knee and hit a senton on it, but as Hoshino would end up putting Necro Butcher in a spinning toe hold, Necro Butcher would manage to roll Hoshino up for the win. So Miyamoto and Necro Butcher get the win. Like I said, this was a very entertaining match, especially live, and it was really cool to get to see the worst balcony dive you'll probably ever see. But overall, this was a really entertaining match. And then the main event of the show is going to be Ryuji Ito and teaming up with Shadow WX to take on Masashi Takeda and Asami Kodaka in a fluorescent light tubes death match. In this match, Shadow WX would end up setting up a pair of light tubes in the corner and trying to send Takeda into the corner, but Takeda would end up stopping himself short, and then Takeda would end up picking up Shadow WX and just sending him into the corner, breaking the light tubes all over Shadow WX. Then Takeda would end up placing Ryuji Ito in the corner and placing a stack of light tubes over him and delivering a dropkick to the light tubes, which would break all over Ryuji Ito. Takeda would then end up setting up a light tube board, but Ryuji Ito would end up coming from behind and delivering a German suplex to Takeda, and then Ito would end up trying to superplex Takeda onto a stack of chairs, but Ito's foot would end up slipping, and Takeda would just barely hit the end of one of the chairs in a really scary looking spot. This could have been really dangerous, with Ito just completely messing up here by accidentally slipping. Shadow WX would then end up grabbing a light tube baseball bat and breaking it over Takeda, followed by Ito breaking a stack of light tubes over Takeda with a kick. And then Ryuji Ito would end up trying to climb up to the top rope, but Asami Kodaka would end up coming from the apron and giving Ryuji Ito a kick, allowing Takeda to pick up Ito and give an Olympic slam to Ito off the top rope onto a barbed wire board, followed by Takeda hitting a dragon suplex on Ryuji Ito for the win. So Takeda and Kodaka get the win. This is to set up Takeda as the next challenger. So Takeda and Kodaka get the win. This is to set up Takeda as the first challenger to Ryuji Ito's deathmatch title.
Freedoms would come back to Shinkiba on July 15th with some changes in the direction of the company after the Korakuen Hall show. Can you talk about the changes and go over some of the matches on the show?
So they would announce a crowd of 195 fans, which is considerably down from what they've been doing in the mid-200s, but overall still a decent number for the promotion. The opening match would be Jintaro, the Winger, and Riki Fuji taking on the Brahmin Brothers in Kin 45, and they would start this match off by brawling all over the building before they would eventually all get back in the ring, and Jintaro would end up putting the sharpshooter on Key, but as he's got that move applied, Shu would come over and spit Indian ink into Jintaro's face, and then Key would end up nailing Jintaro with a zombie kick for the win. So the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45 get the win over Jintaro, who had just got the win in the main event at the last Korakuen Hall show. Now here he is losing the opening match. Mamma Sasaki and Kamui, they team up to take on Tatsuhiro Takeiwa and Masashi Takeda. Mammoth would end up getting Takeda in the corner and begin chopping his chest hard. Takeda would end up coming back and throwing Mammoth in the corner, but Mammoth would end up coming back with a lariat and then hitting a powerbomb on Takeda. Takeda would end up coming back and hitting a German suplex, but Mammoth would get right back up and hit a lariat on Takeda, and then Mammoth would end up hitting a choke slam onto Takeiwa, as Kamui would end up coming off the top and hitting a firebird splash. Takeiwa would end up coming back with a lariat and then hitting a Death Valley bomb on Kamui for the win. So Takeda and Takeiwa, they get a win, in which would actually be their last time teaming up as a tag team. And then the main event is promoted as Takashi Sasaki and Jun Kasai taking on the Great Sasuke and Magnum 2 Kishiwada. So even though Sasuke had helped the Freedom's Army at the Korakuen Hall show, he's still listed here as a Kajika Army member. Well, the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45, they have not forgotten what Sasuke had done. And so at the very start of the match, they bring out a beaten Great Sasuke, followed by the Great Kajika's music playing, with Jintaro carrying Kajika on his shoulders as Jintaro has officially join the Kajika army. So Jintaro here now is a heel, and Jintaro would come in and toss Takashi Sasaki and Jun Kasai out of the ring and begin stomping at the Great Sasuke, with the Great Kajika making the match. It's going to now be Takashi Sasaki, Jun Kasai, and the Great Sasuke taking on Jintaro, Magnitude Kishiwada, and Abdullah Kobayashi. And they would start the match off by brawling all outside the ring before getting back in the ring. The Kajika army, well, they would end up just focusing on the beaten Sasuke one by one before Sasuke would end up hitting a clothesline on Kishiwada and Jintaro as well, and then make the hot tag to Kasai, who would come in and hit Jintaro with a Pearl Harbor splash, with Kishiwada having to make the save by hitting Kasai with the chair before Takashi Sasaki would end up coming in and hitting him with the lariat. Kobayashi would then end up hitting Sasaki with the dropkick, and then Jintaro would end up hitting Sasuke with the Thunderfire powerbomb, but then Kasai would end up trying to hit Jintaro with the reverse tiger driver, but Jintaro would end up hitting a flying head scissors to roll up Kasai for the win, as Jintaro is now going to be pushed as the main heel in Freedom, so he gets the win over Kasai here. So now Jintaro is going to be pushed as the top heel in the promotion, aligned with the Kajika army, but the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45, they would have issues with Jintaro joining the group, and they would end up going after him. So the Brahmin Brothers and Ken 45 now are going to break away from the Kajika army, as the group is going to be changing up here now that Freedoms is going to be going in a different direction now that the Korakuen Hall show has taken place.
Big Japan would run at Korakuen Hall with Ryuji Ito defending his Big Japan Death Match title against Masashi Takeda in what would be a very bloody match. Can you go over this match and what happened that made it so bloody?
Yeah, so the main event of this show is going to be Resident Light Tube's Glassboard Deathmatch. This is for the Big Japan Deathmatch title after Takeda had pinned Ito the previous month in a tag match at Korakuen. In this match, Ito would end up sending Takeda to the outside, with Ito climbing up to the top rope and diving onto Takeda on the outside. Ito would then end up throwing Takeda into a stack of chairs in the crowd, but Takeda would end up returning the favor and sending Ito into a stack of chairs as well. They would end up getting back in the ring, and Takeda would end up charging at Ito, with Ito moving out of the way. And Takeda would end up going through the glass board, and then Ito would end up sending Takeda into the ropes, but Takeda would end up coming back and hitting a spear on Ito, and then Takeda would end up taking one of the broken glass light tubes and begin cutting Ito with it, when Ito would end up moving his head suddenly, and Takeda is not expecting for him to do this, and the light tube would end up going into Takeda's face, and part of the glass would end up cutting open Takeda's eyelid, and blood would begin pouring from Takeda's eyelid as a result. And this is really gruesome here, as Takeda's face is just covered, his eye is just bleeding all over the place. And I actually asked Takeda about this, and he said, it was just centimeters away from him losing his eye because of how dangerous this was, with the glass just unexpectedly blowing up in his face, essentially. Eventually, Takeda would end up picking up Ito and just spearing him into a barbed wire board, as the referee, Nikon Lee, she would take a piece of cloth and begin wrapping it around Takeda's eye to try and stop the bleeding, as Ito would take advantage of this and then slam Takeda, and then grab a bucket of thumbtacks and drop the bucket of thumbtacks all over himself as well as Takeda, and then Ito would end up going for a moonsault, but Takeda would end up moving out of the way as Ito would end up landing on the thumbtacks, and then Takeda would then hit a German suplex on Ito on the thumbtacks. Ito and Takeda would then begin striking each other as the cloth wrapped around Takeda's eye would end up just flying off. Ito would then end up wrapping a stack of light tubes around Takeda, and Ito would end up hitting a dragon splash, breaking the light tubes over Takeda, and then Takeda would end up coming back with a suplex, and then setting up the other glass board on a stack of chairs, and end up hitting a suplex on Ito through the other glass board, with Ito still managing to kick out. They would end up beginning to strike each other once again, with Takeda missing one of the punches, and Ito landing a KO punch, as Ito would end up hitting a German suplex on Takeda, Onita, and then hitting another Dragon Splash on a stack of light tubes for the win. Another awesome match from Takeda. This is probably my favorite Big Japan death match of the year. You know, like I said, this was a really dangerous match for Takeda with how close he was to losing his eye, with how close that eye, the glass was to actually hitting his eye instead of the eyelid. But Takeda's face is just completely covered here. But he's still able to go, and he's able to still show what he's willing to do. You know, this is one of the matches that really kind of, again, just continued the lore of Masashi Takeda. Even though he lost, he is still continuing to try and prove himself, and he's definitely doing so. Big Japan still wouldn't really give him a shot here to be the man for several more years, but, you know, because he's still only 3 years into the business at this point, but already Takeda has established himself as one of the best wrestlers in Big Japan, if not the Japanese independent scene. And, you know, I was following him really closely at this point, and I mean, you couldn't help but be impressed with what he was willing to do and what he was willing to take, and, you know, and still put on an awesome match like this.
Super FMW would return to Shinkiba on July 30th, with Kanemura making his debut with the company. Can you go over what happened at the main event?
So I talked about a little while ago how I attended the Super FMW show back in June, and there was about 100 fans when I was there, and nothing good, but, you know, it wasn't depressing or anything. But this show would look depressing. I was told that there was 50 fans that would attend this show, and it doesn't even look like 50 fans are there. The big name for this show is Kentaro Kanemura. He's going to be in the main event. He's going to team up with another former wing wrestler, Masayoshi Motegi, and they're going to team up with Yusaku Obata, one of Kanemura's allies, and they're going to team up to take on Tarzan Goto, Mr. Pogo, and Yuna Nakata. Goto and Kanemura, they would end up starting off with headbutting one another, with Goto getting the better end of it, and eventually Goto would then begin smashing a chair over Kanemura's head, and then they would begin fighting in the crowd. This would mostly consist of Goto and Pogo just stabbing their opponents with a broken beer bottle, essentially. Pogo and Goto, they would end up teasing having issues with one another when Kanemura would come over thinking that, you know, they have issues, Pogo's gonna side with me, you know, with my, because since, you know, we're former wing buddies. But Goto and Pogo, they would end up attacking Kanemura, and Goto would end up hitting a lariat on him, and then they would begin throwing chairs in the ring as Goto would end up hitting a powerbomb on Obata, and then finishing Obata off with the lariat for the win in a very sad match. Just the crowd's quiet. I don't know. I mean, like I said, the month prior was an awesome match live because they brought in the crowd. I don't know if, you know, there's so few people in the building and it was so quiet, and they mostly stayed around ringside. I don't know if they got that same experience that I did the month prior where, you know, at least the wrestlers were fighting, you know, 2 inches away from you and chairs were getting thrown at you. You know, I don't think that happened on this show. But afterwards, Mr. Pogo would end up getting on the mic and cutting a promo on English randomly, pretty much just saying Mr. Pogo and Tarzan Goto are number one, so it would look like they're going to continue to team, but at the next show, they would actually end up facing off against one another.
Super FMW would then come back to Shinkiba on August 20th with another disappointing crowd. Can you talk about the status of the company and talk about what happened in the main event of the show?
So this would be another depressing Super FMW show. Just like the previous month, I was told there was 50 fans in the building. There does seem to be a little bit more fans at this show than the previous show, but that's not really saying much. On this show, Kanemura would end up coming back, and he's going to take on a guy going by the name Super Leather 2. So it's someone kind of pretending to be Super Leather, but going off the name Super Leather 2, they are acknowledging that this is not the real, like, Mike Kirshner or anything like that. But it is a very bulky looking guy, kind of like how Super Leather looks. So he's definitely trying to portray Super Leather here. He doesn't look like the fake leather face gimmick that so many Japanese independent promotions use. But I don't know who this guy was that was under the mask this time. So Super Leather 2 and Kanemura, they would end up brawling in the crowd. Super Leather would end up controlling the entire match for some reason before hitting a brainbuster on Kanemura for the win. This is actually a really sad time for Kanemura. The fact that, you know, he's pretty much getting squashed by a guy just going by the name Super Leather, and obviously even not the original one, and Kanemura shouldn't even be getting squashed like that anyway. anyway, but at this point, I think he doesn't care as long as he's getting paid at this point. The main event's going to be Tarzan Goto teaming up with Shark Tashia, who is former FMW women's wrestler. You know, she hadn't been wrestling regularly here the last couple years, but Goto gets to bring her back for this show. They're going to team up with Nobuhiro Tsurumaki, who I talked about earlier, a former wing wrestler, and Reina Ayakawa. And they're going to take on the team of Mr. Pogo, Tomonobu Matsumoto, Basara, who is a female wrestler, and Yuta Nakata. This is going to be a thumbtacks death match, and they would start with Goto brawling in the crowd with Matsumoto as Shark Tashia would begin choking Basara with Pogo's chain until Yuta Nakata would end up making the save for Basara and shoving Tashia into a barbed wire board. Matsumoto would then end up sending Goto into a barbed wire board, and then eventually Pogo would end up wrapping his chain around Ayakawa, but Goto would end up grabbing a board with thumbtacks in it and begin smashing it over Pogo's head and then finishing Nakata off with a facebuster for the win. And so another, you know, wild brawl that does not translate to video at all. You know, I mean, overall, not a good match, at least viewing it on tape, but you know, it's just such a depressing sight to watch this promotion at this point and how fast it died, essentially. The promotion is going to keep going here for the next couple months, but what they're doing is not sustainable at all, and it's going to get worse before it gets better.
Jun Kasai would promote his deathmatch tournament on August 25th and August 26th at Shinkiba. Can you go over the tournament and some other matches that took place on the two shows?
So they would announce a crowd of 328 fans for this show, so about 100 fans more would attend this show because it's a deathmatch show. It's a Jun Kasai promoted show. Just like when the Apache Army was struggling the year prior, they would run a Jun Kasai deathmatch show and it would do exceptionally better. That's going to be the case for this show as well as the show the next day as well. And this is going to be the first deathmatch tournament since the 2006 Christmas deathmatch tournament that Jun Kasai put on, which was a one-night eight-person tournament. Well, this is going to be over two nights spread out with just the first-round matches on this show. The first match on this show is actually a non-tournament match. The opening match on this show is going to be a non-tournament match. Mama Sasaki, Riki Fuji, and Ryuichi Sekine, they're going to take on Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Ki, and Ken 45 in a hardcore match. They would end up brawling all over the building to start off. Mammoth would end up grabbing a table, but the Brahmin brothers would end up placing Mammoth on the table, with one of them coming out the turnbuckle on the outside, but the table would not break. Mammoth, Ricky, and Sekine, they would end up picking up the Brahmins in Ken 45 and give them each a kamikaze. Sekine would end up setting up Shu on a stack of chairs, but as he would end up climbing up to the top, Ken 45 would end up hitting him with a crutch, as the Brahmin brothers would end up suplexing him off the top onto a stack of chairs, and then Brahmin Shu would end up hitting a Death Valley Bomb on Sekine on a stack of chairs for the win. So the Brahmin brothers and Ken 45 end up getting the win. The first tournament match of the show is going to be a barbed wire board street fight death match between Jintaro and Kamui. And Kamui would end up throwing a chair at Jintaro's face right away. They would end up brawling in the crowd before getting back in the ring, with Jintaro slamming Kamui into the barbed wire board. Jintaro would end up placing the other barbed wire board outside the ring and toss Kamui over the top rope into it. In a really cool-looking spot. Jintaro would end up climbing up the bleachers and diving onto Kamui, but Kamui would end up coming back and hitting a Pele kick on Jintaro and then setting up Jintaro on a barbed wire board and diving off the top, sending Jintaro through the barbed wire board. Kamui would end up placing the broken barbed wire board over Jintaro and hitting a moonsault onto him, but Jintaro would manage to turn the tide as Kamui would end up going to the top rope. Jintaro would end up putting a chain around Kamui and throwing him off the top into the barbed wire board, followed by Jintaro hitting a belly-to-back suplex on the barbed wire board to get the win over Kamui, so Jintaro ends up advancing into the semifinals of the tournament. The next match would be Takashi Sasaki taking on Masada in a Steel of Pain death match. This is Masada's first match back since the Christmas deathmatch show in 2009. They would start this match with Masada knocking Takashi Sasaki to the outside and going for a tope, but Sasaki would end up meeting him with a shot to the head with a garbage can. They would end up fighting up in the crowd with Sasaki hitting a swinging DDT, and then they would end up getting back in the ring with Takashi putting the trash can over Masada's head and laying him out with a kick to the garbage can. Masato would end up coming back by hitting Takashi Sasaki with a powerbomb into the corner and then hitting a Death Valley bomb for the win. So Masato ends up advancing to the semifinals. Then the next match is the Winger taking on Saburo Inamatsu, who is a Kaintai Dojo wrestler, in a Falls Count Anywhere Scramble Bunkhouse Death Match. They would end up starting off brawling all over the building like usual, and they would eventually get back in the ring with Saburo hitting a Death Valley Bomb on a barbed wire bat and then finishing off the Winger with an Axe Bomber for the win. So this was really nothing of a match. It's literally just to get Saburo advanced into the next round. And then the final first round match and the main event of the show is going to be Jun Kasai taking on the Great Sasuke in a Fluorescent Light Tubes Ladder Death Match. Before the match would even start, Kasai would end up grabbing a fan's beer in the crowd and began smashing his head with the beer before tying up Sasuke. Kasai would end up taking Sasuke up into the entrance ramp of Shinkiba and hitting a pile driver. And then he would end up grabbing a light tube, but he would end up letting Sasuke end up get up and grab a light tube himself, and they would end up trying to hit one another with the light tube, with Sasuke getting the better end of it by hitting Kasai over the head with his light tube. Sasuke would end up grabbing another light tube, but as he would end up turning around, Kasai would get another light tube and smash it over his head. Kasai would then end up hitting Sasuke with a German suplex on the light tubes, and then Kasai would charge at Sasuke, but Sasuke would end up jumping up and hitting the back of Kasai's head. Sasuke would then end up setting up another stack of light tubes on the mat and next to the ladder, and then Sasuke would end up taking Kasai's goggles to mock Kasai, but as Sasuke would climb up the ladder, Kasai would end up getting up and just move the ladder, causing Sasuke to fall off onto the light tubes, breaking all over Sasuke. Eventually, Sasuke would come back and hit a powerbomb on Kasai on the ladder, and then try to do a swanton dive with Kasai moving out of the way, with Sasuke hitting the ladder. Kasai would then hit a clothesline on Sasuke with the light tube set up on the ladder, and then place a light tube on the ladder over Sasuke and hit a Pearl Harbor splash on the Great Sasuke for the win in a very good match. So this was Great Sasuke's kind of makeup for having such a bad match with Takashi Sasaki a couple months earlier at Korakuen Hall. He really embraced the death match, the fluorescent light tubes death match here. I think this was his first time doing it. He had done the exploding barbed wire death match with Onita a couple years earlier. But this was the first time I believe he really went and did the light tubes death matches. And, like I said, this was a really good match, and Sasuke looked really impressive here. And then the next day, they would announce a crowd of 412 fans, which would be an overwhelming sellout for Shinkiba. So they were really smart to break this up over 2 days, because they ended up doing two really good houses with these death matches. The first semifinals match would be a Kinzon death match between Jintaro and Masada. Masada would end up hitting a somersault plancha on Jintaro early on, and then Jintaro would end up coming back by slamming Masada on the Kinzons and then cutting up his head with them. Masada would end up with control of Jintaro by stuffing skewers in Jintaro's head and then slamming a chain over his head and then hitting a half Nelson suplex on a chair to get the win over Jintaro. So Masada advances to the finals of the tournament. And then the next semifinals match is going to be a thumbtacks death match between Jun Kasai and Saburo Inamatsu. They would start off with clotheslining one another before Kasai would end up grabbing the bucket of thumbtacks. But as he was doing that, Saburo would end up hitting a DDT with Kasai's head landing right into the bucket. And then Saburo would end up slamming him onto the tacks and then hitting a Death Valley Bomb as Kasai's back is just covered in thumbtacks. Saburo would end up trying to superplex Kasai, but he would end up escaping and hitting a powerbomb on Saburo onto the tacks, followed by hitting a reverse tiger driver to get the win over Saburo in just a 5-minute match. So this was just, they were having Kasai go pretty light here. I mean, I'm sure, he didn't think so, having a 5-minute match in thumbtacks, but all things considered, they're saving him to wrestle the main event later on the show, so he didn't go full out here. The next match would be a non-tournament match. It's going to be between Mammoth Sasaki and Kamui. And in this match, Kamui would end up throwing a chair right at Mammoth's face as he was entering the ring and delivering a dropkick to it. Kamui would end up taking Mammoth and brawling with him in the crowd before setting up a chair where he would end up jumping off that chair right into Mammoth's arms. Mammoth would eventually end up grabbing the chair and just charging right into Kamui with it. Mammoth would end up taking Kamui up into the ramp of Shinkiba where Kamui would end up kicking Mammoth low, and he would end up grabbing a ladder and placing it between the stands in Shinkiba, and he would end up climbing on top of it and hitting a moonsault off the ladder onto the ramp. Mammoth would end up grabbing that ladder and just throwing it right at Kamui, and then Mammoth would end up picking up Kamui and hit a running powerbomb off the ramp, sending Kamui flying into the ring. Mammoth would then end up placing a chair around Kamui's neck and begin choking him with it. And then eventually Mammoth would begin smashing the ladder right over Kamui, and then he would end up trying for a Mammoth home run, but Kamui would manage to escape and put the chair over Mammoth's head, where he would hit a Mammoth home run on Mammoth, and then Kamui, feeling good about himself, would charge at Mammoth, but Mammoth would end up throwing a chair at Kamui's head and then finish off Kamui with the 29 years old on a chair set up on a ladder for the win. So Kamui showing that he is definitely improved since the last time they fought back in 2008. In the last WMF show, Kamui put up a lot more of a fight here, but Mammoth is always going to defeat Kamui. And then the next match is going to be another non-tournament encounter between Takashi Sasaki and the Great Sasuke, and they're going to go up against the Brahmin Brothers. The Brahmin Brothers, they would end up bringing in a variety of weapons, including a blue mat to the ring for this match. They would end up rolling up Sasuke with that blue mat and standing him up with the blue mat wrapped around him as they would send Takashi Sasaki into him. They would then end up bringing in a pull-up bar that the Great Sasuke would end up grabbing a hold of and trying to pick himself up using the pull-up bar, but Sasuke would end up just falling down with the pull-up bar just falling down with him. Sasuke would end up tagging in Sasaki, who would begin going at it with both Brahmin Brothers, but Brahmin Brother Ki would end up grabbing a hold of Sasaki, and when Shu would try to spit Indian ink into Sasaki's face, Sasaki would move out of the way, and Shu would end up spitting it in Ki's face, and then the Great Sasuke would end up hitting a Thunderfire powerbomb on Ki for the win. So Takashi Sasaki and the Great Sasuke get the win. This is kind of the Great Sasuke's revenge over the Brahmin Brothers here, at least as far as freedoms go. And then the main event in the finals of the deathmatch tournament, Jun Kasai would take on Masada in a glassboard deathmatch. Masada would end up sending Kasai out of the ring and hitting a tope onto him, and then pull out his skewers and begin sticking them into Kasai's head. Kasai would end up fighting back and hitting Masada with the German suplex, and then send Masada flying into the first glassboard in the corner with the glass just exploding all over the place. Kasai would then end up taking Masada out of the ring and tying him up to a table, where Kasai would begin climbing up to the top of Shinkiba and delivering a dive off the balcony of Shinkiba, sending Masada through the table. Kasai would then put the other glass board over Masada's body and would begin climbing up to the top rope. But Masada would end up getting up and hitting a Death Valley bomb off the top turnbuckle, sending Kasai through the other glass board. Kasai would then end up coming back and hitting a lariat, and then following that up with hitting a Pearl Harbor splash with a stack of light tubes placed over Masada. Takashi Sasaki would then hand Jun Kasai a stack of light tubes and place them next to Masada's head, as Kasai would end up kicking the light tubes, breaking them over Masada's head, Takashi Sasaki style. Kasai would then end up trying to hit a reverse tiger driver, but Masada would end up blocking it, and then begin elbowing Kasai in the head, and then hitting a half Nelson suplex, and then do it another time to Kasai to get the win. So Masada ends up winning the deathmatch tournament. This was a really good match, again, kind of like the 2008 match that he had against Kasai, but Masada now has been established as the top deathmatch wrestler, even though he's not a full-time Freedoms wrestler. And also, there's really no prize given to him. He just simply wins. They would at least get a trophy the following year, but this first year, there's just, you won, congratulations. So Masada is the second deathmatch tournament winner, following the Winger winning it back in 2006.
Big Japan would hold a show on September 15th at Shinkiba that would have a very interesting match between some Freedoms wrestlers and independent wrestlers, including Daisuke Masaaka. Can you talk about what happened in the match and who Masaaka was?
Yeah, so Daisuke Masaaka is at this point a Osaka-based independent wrestler who's been wrestling for about 6 years. You know, he's a good high flyer, small wrestler, but he hasn't really done anything of note. He has no real notoriety. The Tokyo wrestlers at this point actually only really know him for having slept with Emi Sakura, the former Emi Motokawa, at this point. But like I said, you know, he's an Osaka wrestler, so he hasn't really interacted with too many of the Tokyo wrestlers. He hasn't really worked for Big Japan or Freedoms much yet. But, you know, he's going to work for Big Japan here. He's going to team up with Shuji Ishikawa and Kenkuro Hoshino, and they're going to have a hardcore match with Jintaro, Mama Sasaki, and Kamui. The Freedoms team, they would end up charging at the independent team with Mammoth and Ishikawa doing a dueling chair spot, and then Ishikawa would send Mammoth out of the ring with Masaaka diving over the top onto Mammoth, and then they would end up brawling all around ringside as Jintaro would end up climbing up the bleachers of Shinkiba and diving onto everybody, and then Mammoth would end up going and coming back with a ladder, and he would end up hitting Masaaka with it and then setting up that ladder between the bleachers, with Kamui getting on top of the ladder and hitting a moonsault onto Hoshino and Masaaka, and then Mammoth would end up placing that ladder around his neck, and as he would go to charge with it, he would be met with a boot to the face by Ishikawa, and then Ishikawa would then pick up Kamui and hit a running powerbomb, sending him into the ring, and then eventually they would all end up brawling outside Shinkiba as Masaaka would end up climbing up the Big Japan truck that's parked right outside the building, and he would end up doing a flip off the truck onto everybody, which was a really cool looking spot, and then the independent guys, they would end up bringing Jintaro back in the ring and begin working on him until Mammoth and Kamui would manage to make the save, and then Kamui would end up hitting a Hurricane Rana on Hoshino, followed by Mammoth hitting a Mammoth home run, and then Mammoth would end up hitting the 29 years old on a stack of chairs on Hoshino for the win. This is one of the best under 9 minute matches you will see. It's just action from bell to bell, just awesome spot after awesome spot, especially Masaaka doing that dive off the Big Japan truck on the outside of Shinkiba. Like I said, this was a really cool match. Not really many people know about it, and you know, since it was just simply a Shinkiba show that Big Japan ran, but it's one of the better matches that I've seen from Big Japan this year.
Mr. Pogo's WWS promotion would have a show on September 20th in Gunma with Tarzan Goto in the main event. Can you go over the main event for us?
So this is going to be the 10-year anniversary for Mr. Pogo's WWS promotion, his small independent promotion that he would run every couple months, mostly based out of his hometown of Gunma. Here, Mr. Pogo is going to team up with Naoya Takase, a WWS wrestler, and Toryu, Magnitude Kishiwada, going by his old gimmick. And they're going to team up to take on Tarzan Goto, Kentaro Kanemura, and Yuji Nakata in a thumbtacks death match. It would start with Goto and Pogo brawling before Goto would begin stabbing Mr. Pogo with a knife before Mr. Pogo would go, "You think that's a knife? Well, here's a knife," and pull out a sickle and begin cutting Tarzan Goto in the forehead with the sickle. Eventually, Kanemura would end up hitting Takase with a senton and covering him, but Takase would manage to kick out, and then Tarzan Goto would end up hitting a face buster on Takase in the thumbtacks with Takase still managing to kick out, barely getting his shoulder up. Eventually, Mr. Pogo would end up taking Nakata and putting him up on top of the ropes and using the top rope to hit a DDT on Nakata into the thumbtacks, with thumbtacks getting stuck all into Mr. Pogo's arm, followed by Mr. Pogo blowing a fireball at Nakata that would barely touch him. This was not the FMW Mr. Pogo fireball that he was shooting back in the 90s, not by any means. It barely touches Nakata here. Eventually, Mr. Pogo would end up wrapping his chain around Nakata's neck and throwing him over the top rope, with Mr. Pogo getting the win by hanging Nakata. And afterwards, Pogo and Goto would end up shaking hands afterwards, showing respect to one another. And as far as I know, this would be the final time that they would work a match against one another or with each other. Mr. Pogo would end up working the Super FMW show 2 weeks later in a singles match. Tarzan Goto would end up just pretty much moving away from Mr. Pogo. The two would end up, you know, just working their own separate promotions, not working with one another. So as far as I know, this was the final time that they would have a match against one another.
Freedoms would come back to Shinkiba on September 21st. Can you go over the two singles matches on the show?
So they would announce a crowd of 184 fans for this show. I would consider it a little bit of a disappointment considering what they were doing earlier in the year, but nothing to be worried about. There'd be a hardcore match on this show between Kamui and Masashi Takeda, with Takeda jumping Kamui right away and sending him into the crowd. But Kamui would end up jumping on the stage and hitting a moonsault onto Takeda, and then Kamui would end up bringing Takeda back in the ring and pulling out a ladder that he'd begin to climb. But Takeda would end up knocking Kamui off the ladder, sending him flying outside the ring. Takeda would then place a board outside outside the ring, but Kamui would end up picking Takeda up and hitting a Death Valley bomb off the apron, sending Takeda through the board on the outside, and then Kamui ended up setting up another board in the corner, but as he would go to charge at Takeda, Takeda would end up catching him and delivering a suplex, sending Kamui through that board. Kamui would then come back and begin climbing up the ladder with Takeda suplexing Kamui off the ladder, and then delivering a German suplex on the ladder, followed by another German suplex on Kamui for the win. This was a really good match. Kamui is very hit or miss, pretty much, and I would consider this a really good match that he put on. You know, he has a lot of creative matches. Sometimes he screws up majorly, but this was, I would consider, a success. And then the main event of the show is Mammoth Sasaki taking on Jintaro. Mammoth would end up going for a chokeslam, but Jintaro would end up blocking it. So Mammoth would then hit a powerbomb to Jintaro, but as Mammoth would end up going for the 29 years old, Jintaro would manage to escape it and roll up Mammoth for a sunset flip for the win. So Jintaro gets the win. You know, this is kind of a sign that, hey, Mammoth, you know, we're glad you're back, but you're not going to be the focal point of the promotion or anything like that. Jintaro, Takashi Sasaki, and to some extent Jun Kasai, you know, they're the faces of this promotion. Mammoth has a lot of, you know, has seniority over pretty much all these wrestlers. You know, he has a name value. They're glad he's back. He has a home in Freedoms, but he's never going to be the focal point of the promotion or the top guy or anything like that. And this loss here, you know, just 3 months after returning, pretty much shows that, you know, hey, Mammoth, you're not going to be the guy of Freedoms. And, you know, right now, Jintaro is the guy of the promotion.
Super FMW would continue its rapid audience decline on October 2nd at Shinkiba. How many people attended the show, and what was the main event?
Yeah, so I mentioned earlier how things were going to get worse before they got better for Super FMW, and this show is a prime example of that, as I was told there were 35 fans in the building for this show. The main event, the big name for this show is Yuko Miyamoto. He's going to team up with Goku Aku Umibozo, and they're going to team up as well with Masahiro Sase, going up against Tarzan Goto, Nobuhiro Tsurumaki, and Yuta Nakata. Goto would then go to slam Miyamoto, but Miyamoto would manage to escape and go after Goto's knees, with Goku Aku and Sase knocking Goto into the thumbtacks. Goto would begin throwing chairs in the ring and eventually powerbombing Sase onto one of them before putting him in a single leg crab in the thumbtacks, with Sase giving up for the Tarzan Goto win. And like I said, this is becoming more and more sad for the Super FMW promotion, and this is not sustainable. A promotion with just cannot continue to keep going with so few people attending their shows.
Kanemura and Kuroda would return to 0-1 to take on their old rivals, Shinjiro Otani and Masada Tanaka, on October 11th at the Shinjuku Face. What set up this match, and what happened in the match?
Yeah, so this is going to be a Tanaka and Otani promoted show, and they're going to book this match with Kanemura and Kuroda based on the fact that they had some really hot matches in 2002 and 2003 together. They would end up holding a press conference before the match with all four of them there, with Kanemura taking exception to something that Otani had said, and Kanemura would end up getting up in the press conference and slapping Otani in the face, with Otani slapping him back. So that sets up the match that there's still some heated, there's a heated rivalry between the two. You know, the Apache Army feud between 0-1, it never really truly ended. It just kind of, you know, stopped after a couple years. But they would end up having a match with Kanemura. He ends up coming to the ring with a Bumblebee Transformer shirt for this match, so he's not really wearing ring gear here. Tanaka would end up taking Kanemura outside the ring, but Kuroda would end up helping Kanemura out by laying Tanaka out on a table, as Kanemura would climb up to the upper level of Shinjuku Face and dive off of it, sending Tanaka through the table, and then Kuroda would then ram the table into Tanaka. Kanemura and Tanaka would end up making it back in the ring, with Kanemura trying to pick up the piece of the broken table, but Tanaka would end up taking it from him and begin smashing it over his head, and then Tanaka would end up hitting the stunner DDT combo on both Kanemura and Kuroda, and then Tanaka would end up hitting the Superfly Splash on Kanemura. Tanaka would try for a running backslide, but Kanemura would end up rolling up Tanaka with a backslide followed by a German suplex, and then Kuroda would end up coming in and hitting Otani with the powerbomb, followed by Kanemura hitting a senton splash, and then Kuroda would end up grabbing a hold of Otani, with Kanemura charging at him, but Otani would end up getting his boot up, and then Kuroda would end up going for a lariat, But Otani would end up hitting an enziguri on Kuroda, followed by a dragon suplex, and then a spider bomb for the win. And so Otani and Tanaka get the win over Kanemura and Kuroda, with Otani pinning Kuroda. And afterwards, Kanemura and Kuroda would end up shaking Otani and Tanaka's hands, as this would be the symbol that the 2002-2003-2004 Apache Army 01 feud is officially over, with Kanemura and Kuroda finally giving respect to the 01 team.
Freedoms would run a show on October 11th at the Sapporo Tyson Hall. What happened in the main event match between the Kojika Army and the Freedoms Army?
Yeah, so the main event of the show is going to be Takashi Sasaki, Jun Kasai, and Hiroki taking on Great Kajika, Jintaro, and Onryo. They would end up fighting outside the ring, with Onryo climbing up to the top rope and diving off of it onto everybody outside the ring. Great Kajika would then act like he was going to dive onto everybody, but he would end up thinking better of it. Takashi Sasaki would end up going after Kajika, and as Sasaki was about to hit Kajika with a kick to the head, Jintaro would end up making the save by grabbing Sasaki's leg, although Hiroki would end up delivering a trance kick to Kajika anyway. Jintaro would then end up laying his body over Kajika to try and save him, as Kasai would end up hitting a Pearl Harbor Splash on both of them, and then as Kasai would end up trying to hit a reverse Tiger Driver, Onryo would end up throwing powder in his face, resulting in Kajika rolling up Kasai for the win. So Kajika ends up getting the win over Kasai using all types of heel tactics, the powder in the face, but the Kajika Army walk away the winners.
Freedoms would come back to Shinkiba on October 28th with a Kajika Army member turning face and joining the Freedoms Army. Can you go over the top matches and who was the wrestler that made the switch on the show?
Yeah, so on this show, they would announce a crowd of 153 fans, so another show that is below the 200 mark that they had been doing regularly at the beginning of this year. On this show, Mama Sasaki would team up with the Winger and Kamui, and they're going to go up against Kazuhiko Ogasawara and Brahmin Shu and Brahmin Key. Mammoth would end up going to powerbomb Key when Brahmin Brothers Shu would end up spitting Indian ink in Mammoth's face, and then the Brahmin Brothers would end up placing a chair over Mammoth's knee and begin smashing his knee with the chair before Brahmin Brothers Key would end up putting Kamui away with the school shooter, which is a very interesting finishing name that I don't think would fly in many places these days. So the Brahmin Brothers get the win, and afterwards they continue to beat down Mammoth and Kamui when Ricky Fuji would roll in the ring to try and help Kamui and Mammoth, but they would end up going after him as well when Ken 45 would rush in the ring to make the save for Ricky and attack the Brahmin Brothers and clear out the ring, as Ken 45 now has officially turned face and left the Kajika Army. So Ken 45, he's been with the Brahmin Brothers since the Apache Army days, the beginning of 2009 and prior, with Michinoku Pro. Well, he is now joining up with Ricky Fuji, simply because him and Ricky Fuji have a real band that I'll talk about here in a couple minutes. You know, Ricky Fuji and Ken 45 and the Great Sasuke, they're going to start up their own band. And so Ken 45 is leaving the Brahmin Brothers group and has turned face. And then the main event's going to be Jintaro and Dick Togo. They're going to defeat Takashi Sasaki and Masashi Takeda, with Jintaro hitting a backdrop on Takeda for the win. Really nothing of note of this match. It's just a standard main event and nothing special, nothing even really to talk about for this match.
Miss Mongol would promote an FMW reunion show on November 22nd at the Yokohama Red Brick Warehouse, with a no-ropes barbed wire death match with Atsushi Onita coming out of retirement. Can you go over the match?
Yeah, so this is going to be a Miss Mongol 15th anniversary show. You know, she started in the FMW dojo when Onita was at the top of, you know, at the peak of his popularity. So I'm sure she was a fan of this style and, you know, always wanted to be a part of this match, but probably knew she never could because the women weren't involved in these kind of matches back then. But she's going to book this match. She's going to team up with Onita, and they're going to team up with Masato Tanaka and Tetsuhiro Kuroda, and they're going to take on Mr. Pogo, Ricky Fuji, Hideki Osaka, and the Winger in a no-rope barbed wire death match. The match would start off with Onita throwing his jacket and going after Mr. Pogo at first, but eventually finding Hideki Osaka, who he would end up taking outside the ring and just throwing into the crowd. Eventually, Onita would end up pile-driving Hosaka through a table on the outside, but then the winger would end up throwing Miss Mongol into the barbed wire, and then Mr. Pogo would begin using his sickle on her, and then eventually Mr. Pogo would begin using his sickle on Onita's back with blood coming out, but Onita would end up grabbing a piece of the broken table and smashing it over Pogo's head, and Ricky would end up picking up Miss Mongol and hitting a kamikaze on her, with Onita having to make the save for her. The winger would then end up picking up Onita and holding on to him as Mr. Pogo would come over with his sickle, as Onita would end up spraying green mist into Pogo's face. Onita would then end up throwing the winger into the barbed wire and hitting a thunderfire powerbomb, as Miss Mongol would end up climbing up a ladder and then delivering a dive off the ladder onto the winger for the win. Afterwards, Onita would end up letting Miss Mongol wear his leather jacket, as she would end up doing the Onita post-match celebration with him, which I'm sure was kind of always a dream for her. You know, again, she got into the business right at the time. When she started, Onita had already retired, but she got it and she joined the dojo when Onita was right there at the peak of his popularity in 95 in FMW. And so, like I said, I'm sure this was something that, you know, hey, she's willing to promote it. She's willing to put the money down for the building to pay the wrestlers. She wants this experience and she's going to have it. And, you know, she gets to have this no rope barbed wire dream match with Onita as her partner, and they get to celebrate afterwards.
Freedoms would have a show on November 25th at Shinkiba. Can you go over this show and the decline attendance for the promotion?
Yes, so they would announce a crowd of 149 fans, which is not a good number compared to what they had been doing at Shinkiba this past year, but this was really nothing special of a lineup, so I don't think they really thought much of this show. The main event is going to be Takashi Sasaki, Jun Kasai, Riki Fuji, and Ken 45 taking on Magnitude Kishiwada, Antonio Honda, Abdullah Kobayashi, and Kazuhiko Ogasawara. They would start off this match by brawling all over Shinkiba like usual, but eventually they ended up getting back in the ring before they would all end up brawling outside the ring again. Sasaki and Kasai, they try to get back in the ring as the referee is counting everyone out, and Antonio Honda and a couple of the other Kajika Army members prevent Kasai and Sasaki from getting back in the ring, as the referee would end up counting both teams out, which would result in both teams being tied 1-1. So now the next fall is going to be the determination of who wins the match. Eventually, the entire Kajika Army, they would begin attacking Ken 45, with Great Kajika trying to throw powder at Ken 45, but instead Ken 45 would move out of the way and Kajika would end up throwing it in Magnitude Kishiwada's face, but it wouldn't matter, as Kishiwada would end up putting Ken 45 away with a last ride powerbomb for the win. So the Kajika Army get the win, and then Great Kajika, he ends up getting on the mic and announcing the newest member of the Kajika Army, and that would be Tsuyoshi Kikuchi, who had been wrestling in All Japan in the 90s, and he had been working for Noah. Well, Noah had just recently let him go, and so now he's a freelance worker, so he's going to begin working Freedoms and other independent promotions. So Kikuchi ends up coming to the ring, but he would begin attacking Kajika, as he would actually side with the Freedoms Army. So Kikuchi is going to be a face here for the Freedoms Army here for the next couple shows.
Kentaro Kanemura would hold a press conference on November 25th announcing the return of the Apache Army. What did Kanemura announce that would make this different than the previous Apache Army ran by Takashi Sasaki?
Yeah, so Kanemura would announce that he's going to restart up the Apache Army promotion. This is going to have nothing to do with Takashi Sasaki or Freedoms. You know, they gave up a name to the Apache Army last year, and so Kanemura, he's going to, you know, use the name once again that he started up, the promotion that he started up, the name that he came up with. So this is going to be his promotion, even though realistically, he's going to only just really be the face of the promotion. Kazutaka Hasegawa, he's going to be the financer behind the promotion. He's going to be the guy in charge. He is a very young, wealthy guy who is a very big wrestling fan. So he's got a lot of money. He has the money to start up this small independent promotion. Like I said, Kanemura is going to be the face of the promotion. He's always going to be the face of the Apache Army promotion. The Apache Army promotion can't go without Kanemura. And so the first show of the restart of the Apache Army is going to be December 17th.
Super FMW would hold another show on November 27th. What happened on this show, and did it do any better than the last show?
Yeah, so I was told there was 40 fans for this show. So a little bit up from the previous show back in October, but still a scary low number. The main event's going to be Tarzan Goto, Nobuhiro Tsurumaki, Yuta Nakata, and Reina Ayukawa going up against Yuko Miyamoto returning to the promotion. The winger, Kamui, and Tobunobu Matsumoto in a hardcore street fight. So Kamui's kind of the big new name coming in for the promotion. Goto would end up going after Kamui right away and begin cutting open his arm with a broken beer bottle before throwing a bunch of chairs in the ring and hitting Matsumoto with a powerbomb before throwing Ayukawa on top of him for the win. So this is going to be the final Shinkiba show for the year for Tarzan Goto and Super FMW. They would run one more Shinkiba show in early 2011. I'm not going to talk about this promotion in any future episodes. Eventually, he would downsize the promotion and begin just working the Kita Senchu Theater, which is a very small building where they would only average about 25 fans, before just giving up on Tokyo altogether and running just built shows in Shizuoka, which is a city outside Tokyo, and then eventually the promotion would just stop running until 2018, when Tarzan Goto would promote a show at Shinkiba last December, and then there's going to be another show, Super FMW show, at Shinkiba later this year. So even into 2019, Super FMW with Tarzan Goto continues to live. It will never die.
Kanemura would take on Arashi on December 14th at the Shinjuku Face for the Tenryu Project. What was Tenryu Project, and what happened in this match?
So the Tenryu Project was essentially Tenryu wanting to promote shows again. You know, he had promoted the SWS and then War after that. Well, War closed down in 2000, and Tenryu joined up with All Japan, and, you know, for a couple years he's their top wrestler, one of their top wrestlers. Well, now, you know, he's a freelance worker once again, and, you know, he misses promoting. And so he starts up this semi-regular promotion that runs every so often, every couple months, or where it's mostly going to be a mix between the old War wrestlers that he used to book in the 90s, and, you know, just some independent wrestlers as well to kind of fill out the cards. And so on this show, Kanemura, he's going to take on Arashi being a former War wrestler as well. This is going to be a lumberjack match, and they would start off just pretty much Arashi just knocking Kanemura out of the ring repeatedly, with the lumberjacks having to throw Kanemura back in the ring. Eventually, Kanemura would end up getting control of the match and throwing Arashi out of the ring, and he wants nothing to do with the lumberjacks, as he ends up placing Arashi on a table outside the ring, and Kanemura would end up climbing up to the top and sending Arashi through the table, diving off the top rope. Eventually, Kanemura would end up shoving Arashi into the referee and then trying to smash him in the head with a piece of the broken table, but Arashi would end up grabbing it from Kanemura and smashing it over his head, and then hitting Kanemura with a powerbomb for the win. So Arashi defeats Kanemura. Afterwards, Kanemura and Arashi, they would end up shaking hands, and Kanemura would be bowing to the crowd as Arashi would leave. Well, then Tomohiro Ishii would all of a sudden pop up and hit the ring and hit Kanemura with the lariat, and then grab a chair and begin smashing the chair over Kanemura. Afterwards, Kanemura and Ishii would end up meeting backstage, where Ishii's like, "Hey, I'm still the WWE champion. Did you forget? You know, it's been over almost 2 years since I've defended this title. You want it back? You gotta beat me." And so this is pretty much just bringing the WEW title back to life. It's just been pretty much dormant for essentially nearly 2 years, since January 2009, when Ishii defended it over defeating Kanemura. So they agreed to set up a match in 2011 where Kanemura will once again challenge for the WEW title.
Freedoms would hold their first show at the Shinjuku Face on December 15th. Can you tell us about some of the matches that took place?
Yeah, they would announce 285 fans for this show, which is not a good number for the 650-seat building at Shinjuku Face, but, you know, this card wasn't really anything special, and Freedoms, ever since the Deathmatch tournament, hasn't really been clicking. You know, I feel like the fans really love the death matches. They loved Jun Kasai, and, you know, this, you know, so that, which is just a completely different side of Freedoms. You know, the death matches, Jun Kasai, Takeda, Light Tubes, glass board death matches. Well, you know, this, then there's this other side of Freedoms, that, which is what Takashi Sasaki wants the direction to be, which is, you know, him as the top baby face, Jintaro as the top heel, his best friend, and then, you know, kind of mix in with some older veterans and, you know, some of the indie guys, and, you know, that's what makes this Freedoms. Well, this Freedoms, you know, that Takashi Sasaki is trying to promote isn't really doing that well, and, you know, like I said, none of these shows, at least since the Deathmatch tournament, have been doing really well, because now I feel like the fans have gotten that taste of the Deathmatch back in August, and hey, everything else doesn't compare to what they did back in August, and so now you even run a bigger building with just standard matches, and the fans have no interest, really. On this show, though, there would be a hardcore match between Yuko Miyamoto and Kamui. Kamui would end up setting two boards next to the turnbuckle and placing another board on top of them as he would end up climbing up to the top of those boards and diving off them onto Miyamoto. Miyamoto would end up going to the outside where Kamui would just throw one of the boards at his head. And then Kamui would then place Miyamoto on another board and get on top of the upper level of Shinjuku Face where the fans are drinking or lay their drinks on top of. And he would end up hitting a Swanton Bomb, sending Miyamoto through the board. Miyamoto would end up coming back and setting up Kamui on a board himself and hitting a moonsault, sending Kamui through that board. And then eventually he would end up putting Kamui away with a Fire Thunder on a stack of chairs. So this was a battle between the two WMF dojo wrestlers. Miyamoto has more seniority and is way more accomplished. He's going to get the win every time over Kamui. And in the main event, it's going to be Takashi Sasaki and Jintaro in a 2 out of 3 falls match. Like I said, this was kind of what Takashi Sasaki wanted his freedoms to be at this point. And, you know, him and his best friend on top, you know, main eventing. And, I mean, like I said, the show didn't do very well overall. They really are promoting Jintaro as this, you know, classic wrestler having great matches. And I've already talked about it a bunch, how I am not a fan. And I hated this match so much when I first watched it. In 2011. I hated it. I didn't really want to watch the clips too much to re-experience this match. I just thought it was so boring. The match goes nearly 30 minutes. You know, Jintaro gets the first pin. Takashi Sasaki gets the second pin to tie it. And then Takashi Sasaki ends up winning with a lariat in a 28-minute match. Like I said, at this point, I hated Jintaro as a wrestler. You know, just this whole year has been pretty much just him been boring me. I've watched every Freedom show in 2010, and it just every match he was in just bored me pretty much. One of the only entertaining matches I thought he had was against Great Kajika, and it by no means was a good match. It was just that Great Kajika was able to pull out moves you didn't think he could do. But this match, completely disappointed in it. Just, you know, Takashi Sasaki, he's on the decline at this point as well. He's not a great wrestler at this point, even after just having some great matches the year prior. And Jintaro, like I said, he's just, this style that he's doing is not working for me. And, I mean, at least as far as drawing-wise, it's not working for Freedoms as well.
Michinoku Pro would hold a show on December 16th at Korakuen Hall with an interesting main event. Can you tell us about it?
So the main event of this show is going to be the Great Sasuke, Riki Fuji, and Ken 45 teaming up to take on Shusato Kisato, the Brahmin brothers going by their real name, and Taro Nohashi. And this match is going to be the Great Space Battle, which is Michinoku Pro's annual event every December at Korakuen Hall. The match would start with just Shu and Ki in the ring with Taro Nohashi nowhere to be found when all of a sudden the lights would turn off and Nohashi would appear in a neon green glow-in-the-dark outfit on the balcony at Korakuen Hall. And, you know, everyone's cheering for him as the lights are off. And he begins going down the balcony with this, like, spiderweb-type string where he would end up sliding down with it. But eventually, he ends up sliding down this string and just falling into the barrel that's been placed right outside the ring before the match would start. Eventually, the match would start with just a lot of senseless brawling, but there's these drones, these mass drones around ringside, and they begin just tearing the ring apart as the match continues. So they start off untying the ropes and then eventually taking the mat apart. Eventually, the Brahmin brothers, they would end up picking up the barrel with Nohashi in it, and Nohashi would end up, you know, finally waking up and participating in this match. But eventually, Riki Fuji and Ken 45, they would end up wrapping the ring mat around Nohashi, and again, he would be taken out of the match. Eventually, the Great Sasuke, he would end up taking two ladders and putting them next to each other and then placing a bar onto both of them and then trying to do that pull-up spot that he did and tried to do in Freedoms a couple months ago. And once again, he would end up falling down and it would not end up working out. Eventually, Sasuke would end up climbing up the ladder and just diving off of it onto the outside, but he would end up just landing on the barrel outside the ring. And then Shu and Ki, they would end up hitting a powerbomb on Sasuke on one of the beams holding up the structure of the ring. So Sasuke ends up just falling down to the bottom below the ring. They would end up pulling Nohashi out of the ring mat, and Nohashi would end up grabbing a guitar, and he would begin playing the guitar as he was about to hit Ken 45, but he ends up taking too long to play this guitar. It's like he's playing a solo, and Ken 45, this gives him the time to end up pulling out his own guitar and smashing Nohashi over the head with the guitar. Eventually, they would end up dumping flour all over Nohashi, so he was just covered in flour, and Sasuke would end up diving off the ladder for the win, so the Sasuke team gets the win in a 28-minute match. Again, so like I said, there's a lot of dead air, a lot of senseless brawling to make this match go 28 minutes, but there's also a lot of really cool spots thrown in there as well, but, you know, like I said, overall, I wouldn't say this is an awesome match because of just how much nothing is going on in between these awesome spots. And then afterwards, the great Sasuke, Riki Fuji, and Ken 45, like I said, they have their own band called Crazy Crew, and they began playing Bon Jovi song after Bon Jovi song with, you know, for the last 20 minutes of the show. So it becomes a full-on concert for this band here as they sing song after song to close out this very interesting show.
The return of the Apache Army promotion would take place on December 17th at Shinkiba. What ended up taking place here?
Yeah, so this is going to be the first show for the restart of the Apache Army. I may mention how Kazutaka Hasegawa, he's the promoter. He's the one putting all the money into the promotion. But he has actually assigned Tomohiko Hashimoto to be the booker of the promotion. Hashimoto had been running the Makihin promotion the year prior and had recently closed down. So this promotion is actually very similar to the Makihin promotion, even more so than the original Apache Army that Kanemura was running in 2004. 2005, 2006. So, you know, this is a very small independent promotion. Hashimoto is going to have the book. He's going to book himself on this show against the biggest name outsider, which is Takeo Omori, a former All Japan and NOAH wrestler. And Omori's going to get the win with the Axe Bomber over Hashimoto. And then the main event's going to be Kentaro Kanemura and Tetsuhiro Kuroda going up against Arashi and Dick Togo in a spectators throw the chair in the ring match, where it's going to be similar to what the XWF promotion did in 2008. Where after 10 minutes, the fans all throw all their chairs in the ring. And so during this match, Kanemura and Togo, they end up going at it with one another, with Kanemura delivering a Hurricane Rana to Togo. But eventually, Togo would end up hitting a super kick to Kanemura and then placing him in the crossface when the 10-minute mark would hit. And Togo would end up just letting go of the move and head out of the ring, with Kanemura barely managing to roll out of the ring as all the fans would begin throwing their chairs in the ring. Eventually, Kanemura would end up taking one of the chairs and hitting Togo with it, and then climbing up to the top, but Togo would end up grabbing Kanemura and suplexing him off the top rope onto a stack of chairs, and then Arashi would end up coming in and hitting Kuroda with the choke slam, and then hitting a powerbomb on him for the win. So Arashi and Togo get the win. Afterwards, Kanemura would get on the mic and ask for the entire roster to come out, which would consist of Tetsuhiro Kuroda, Shinjuku Shark, former FMW wrestler, independent wrestler Hiroshi Kosaki, and Tomohiro Waki, who had just made his debut on this show. They would all end up doing the Team No Respect dance to end this show. So the Apache Army, they're going to run one show a month at Shinkiba, and that's going to be pretty much it. There'll be maybe one outside booking outside of Tokyo every so often, but this is mostly going to be kind of what Freedoms was at the very, very beginning, where it's just one show a month at Shinkiba. That's all they can really afford to do at this point.
Big Japan would run at the Yokohama Bunka Gym on December 19th. Can you go over some of the matches on this show?
So this show is going to have the only singles match between Jun Kasai and Masashi Takeda in 2010. It's going to be a Razor Cross Board death match. They would start the match by going to shake each other's hand, but they would both end up kicking each other low as they were going to shake each other's hand. Takeda would end up picking Kasai up and sending him into the Razor Cross Board, followed by suplexing him onto it. And then Takeda would end up climbing up to the top rope, but Kasai would end up getting up and suplexing Takeda off the top rope onto the Razor Cross Board. And then Kasai would end up up putting a ladder around his neck and began hitting Takeda with it, but Takeda would end up grabbing Kasai and delivering a German suplex with the ladder still around Kasai's neck as he would end up taking the suplex. Takeda would then try to suplex Kasai on the Razor Crossboard, but Kasai would end up kicking him low and suplexing Takeda on the Razor Crossboard instead, followed by hitting a reverse Tiger Driver on the Razor Crossboard, and then placing Takeda on the ladder where he would end up hitting a reverse Tiger Driver off the ladder for the win. So Kasai ends up again defeating Takeda. And then the main event of the show is going to be Ryuji Ito taking on Abdullah Kobayashi in a fluorescent light tubes death match. And light tubes are all over the place in this match. They're covered all around the ropes. They're all over the mat. They would end up not being able to even really walk around the ring at first because there's all these light tubes just on the mat. So they take it to the outside pretty quickly into the match with Kobayashi throwing Ito into the crowd. They would end up getting back in the ring with Kobayashi setting up stacks upon stacks of light tubes, but Ito would end up smashing them over his head with more light tubes and then trying to powerbomb Kobayashi, which would be a dumb move as Kobayashi would end up picking Ito up and backdropping him into a stack of light tubes. And then Kobayashi would then climb up to the top and Ito would end up smashing him over the head with light tubes and then breaking a bunch of light tubes over his head and then hitting a flying drop kick, breaking more light tubes, and then eventually Ito would end up hitting a dragon splash for the win. And so, again, this is, you know, Ryuji Ito's time as the ace of the company. He's the focal point, and they are going to give him a long run here as champion. This match overall, I think, was the official fluorescent light tubes have been overdone. It's not a bad match, but it's not necessarily good. But the overwhelmingness of how many light tubes were used in this match, like I said, at this point, it's becoming a little too much as far as this one single weapon.
Jun Kasai would promote his annual Christmas Deathmatch show on December 25th at Shinkiba. Can you talk about some of the matches that took place?
Yeah, so in comparison to the Shinjuku Face show I talked about a little while ago, that only drew 200-plus fans in a 600-seat building, here you have this show announcing a crowd of 435 fans in this building that probably only fits about 350 fans usually, but if you throw in enough chairs, like Mr. Ganosuke did for his retirement, you can fit in 400-plus people in this building. And again, this is just showing the death matches in Freedoms is clicking. Jun Kasai on top clicks. Those straight wrestling matches, they don't do that well, especially in comparison to the deathmatch shows. But they, at this time, they still feel like the deathmatch shows need to be kept special to be able to draw these good numbers. If you keep doing it every month, a show like this won't end up drawing a complete sellout at Shinkiba. It'll just be like every other month. And so their idea is to keep these deathmatch shows special for the time being. The opening match is going to be Kamui taking on Kenkoro Hoshino, and they would start off with doing the dueling chair spot with Kamui delivering a dropkick to Hoshino while holding the chair, sending him out of the ring, and then Kamui would end up hitting a plancha to the outside, and then they would end up brawling in the crowd with Kamui hitting a moonsault onto Hoshino, and then eventually Kamui would end up leaving Shinkiba as he would get into his new minivan. I talked about it last episode, how Kamui used his own car in a match against Masada, and they pretty much just destroyed it together, you know, doing power bombs and Death Valley bombs on top of his car. Well, now Kamui has a new minivan, and he ends up getting into it, and the garage door of Shinkiba begins to open, and Kamui backs into Shinkiba, and he hits Hoshino with his minivan while backing into the building, and then Kamui would end up climbing up to the top of his minivan and delivering a swanton bomb, sending Hoshino through the table off the minivan, and Kamui ends up getting the win. This was nothing compared to what he had done the year prior against Masada. That was such an awesome match. This match was okay. You know, there wasn't as many spots using the automobile, but, you know, this is a new car for Kamui. I'm sure, you know, he realized he was gonna get rid of that car anyway, and, you know, for this new minivan, and so, you know, he's only willing to, you know, do a spot off it. He's not willing to actually damage his car or anything like that as a result. And they would end up doing more matches like this and as the years go by, and I talked about it last episode, you know, this match and all those other matches, nothing compared to the match that they did last year, 2009 Christmas Death Match with Kamui and Masada. And then there's going to be a barbed wire board death match between Mammoth Sasaki and Masashi Takeda, and they would start out by brawling on the ramp of Shinkiba, with Mammoth hitting a running powerbomb, sending Takeda into the ring, and then Mammoth would try to send Takeda into the barbed wire board, but Takeda would manage to reverse it and send Mammoth through the barbed wire board. Mammoth would end up getting control back of the match and trying to hit a powerbomb on Takeda on the barbed wire board, but Takeda would manage to escape and spear Mammoth into that barbed wire board instead. And then Takeda would try to suplex Mammoth, who would end up breaking free and hitting Takeda with the lariat. And then Mammoth would hit an awesome bomb, followed by picking up the broken barbed wire board and placing it over Takeda and hitting a leg drop onto it. And then Mammoth would end up getting the win with the 29 years old onto Takeda in a very short and disappointing match. Mammoth would end up putting out his hand afterwards, and Takeda would end up just kicking him and leaving the ring really upset. And like I said, this was not by any means a great match, very disappointing, and it only went 9 minutes. Definitely didn't get the showcase of Takeda's abilities, and sadly, Mammoth really never was the same after his car accident in 2009. He had just been through his prime in 2007-2008, having classic matches against Ishii and Sekimoto, main eventing Korakuen Hall. And ever since he came back, he's still a good, capable wrestler. Even to this day, almost a decade since he's came back from his injury, he's still pretty much the same. Where he can go, he can have a very good match, but he is not going to have a classic match anymore. He's, I don't know if it's just the car accident that, resulted in him not being able to train as hard, or just, age catching up, but he just really never was the same. This Mammoth Sasaki throughout the 2010s has never been a classic wrestler or an awesome, amazing wrestler like he was for those couple years right before the injury. And, he's going to have matches like this that are disappointing as results, where, maybe he doesn't want to go full all out like he used to a couple years earlier. So the main event's going to be Takashi Sasaki going up against Jun Kasai. Jun Kasai's original opponent was supposed to be Sami Callihan, but what had happened to him was similar to what had happened to Super Leather earlier in the year, where, they both do this 12, 14, 16-hour flight to Narita, and then they get to immigration after getting off the plane, and the immigration officer has been tipped off that they're trying to get into this country without a work visa. Just like the Super Leather incident, it's a rival promoter. I don't know if it was the same guy or another somebody else, but somebody's snitching, and somebody snitched to the immigration officer that Sami Callihan, he is coming into this country to work, and his visa, or he doesn't have a work visa. Takashi Sasaki Freedoms haven't paid for a work visa for him to come over. They're just saying, hey, fly on over here. We'll pay you for your plane ticket. You just fly over here and, just say you're coming here, for tourism. But when the rival promoter ends up giving the poster with Sami Callihan on it to the immigration office, they have it in front of them, and Sami Callihan is, pulled aside, and, you can't enter the country. Look, we have a Freedoms poster with you on it. We know that you're trying to come here to work, to get paid. You're not coming here just to be a tourist. And so Sami Callihan has to end up going back. He has to fly back. He's essentially not allowed in the country. He ends up having to fly back to America. So he just did this, 14, 15, 16-hour flight just to end up having to go right back. And it's simply just because Takashi Sasaki didn't put the money down to get Callihan a working visa. So Sasaki, he's going to take over for Callihan here. And this is going to be a glass board death match. Kasai would end up trying to hit Sasaki with a reverse tiger driver, but Sasaki would end up reversing it and sending Kasai into the first glass board. And then Takashi would end up taking some of the broken glass and begin scraping across Kasai's forehead. And then Kasai would end up coming back and successfully hitting a reverse tiger driver, and then a Pearl Harbor splash on Sasaki. Kasai would then end up placing the other glass board over Sasaki's body, but as he would climb up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash, Sasaki would roll out from under the board, but Kasai would end up hitting a reverse tiger driver, sending Sasaki through the glass board. And then Sasaki and Kasai, they would begin exchanging suplexes and then exchanging lariats, as Sasaki would end up picking up Kasai and hitting a D-Jice, with Kasai managing to kick out at one. And then Sasaki would end up placing a stack of light tubes and delivering a kick, breaking it over Kasai's head, as the fans would begin loudly chanting for Kasai. Again, you know, Takashi Sasaki, he's promoting himself as the number one face of this promotion, but this is a Jun Kasai deathmatch environment, and they are all for Kasai here. Kasai would end up gaining momentum and placing a light tube on Sasaki, and then hitting a Pearl Harbor Splash, breaking the light tube over Sasaki, with Sasaki managing to kick out, but then Kasai would end up hitting a reverse Tiger Driver on Sasaki for the win. So this was a good match overall. This match would really kind of show, and again, it's a Jun Kasai promoted show, so he's going to have more of his fan base, especially, you know, the deathmatch fans. But this shows really that Jun Kasai, he is the most beloved wrestler in Freedoms, even though right now Takashi Sasaki, you know, he kind of wants the promotion built around him at this point. You know, he's the booker, he's the guy running the promotion. You know, Sasaki really respects Jun Kasai. He's, you know, the number two guy in his mind, but you know, going forward, Takashi Sasaki is going to have to realize that everybody, you know, the fan base is for Jun Kasai as the top guy, not for Sasaki. And this match really hammers home that point.
All right, Brett, can you go over where people can find you at?
Yeah, so you can find my website at BahuFMW.com or FMWWrestling.us. I have several very detailed FMW biographies on there. I have results over the last 30 years compiled. I have news updates of all the former FMW wrestlers, as well as what's going on with Freedoms. I also have numerous DVDs and MP4s for sale of FMW, Freedoms, and several other promotions in between. And also, you can find all the history of FMW YouTube videos on my website as well. I wanted to talk about that for 1 second. My YouTube account has been deleted once again, so all the videos got deleted. So I have started back up two YouTube accounts. One is going to be unlisted, where you can find them on my website. So hopefully I won't have any issues with those videos ever getting taken down again. So you can find those at BahuFMW.com. I have all the career music videos listed, as well as all 37 history of FMWs. And as soon as I'm finished with this, this one will be included, as well as the Kentaro Kanemura interview I did with him last year. Also, I have started up another YouTube account with the plan of watermarking all the videos that, and as far as I know, those videos are pretty much free from being deleted. Fingers crossed. I know the person that has been deleting my YouTube videos, he has gone through these videos as well that are up, and these videos survive. So I'm hoping, with the fact that I am watermarking the videos with an FMW logo, it's going to be able to keep these videos up for the, you know, for a good amount of time. But if for some reason, you know, they decide that, you know, hey, you don't own this footage, so we're going to delete them. If that happens, like I said, the videos are at my website at BahuFMW.com, as well as the History of FMW Facebook group. So if you want to, you know, if for some reason the YouTube videos get deleted, you can go to those two sites. So BahuFMW.com and History of FMW on Facebook. Just search that. And I also include many other FMW videos and pictures and you know, socially interacting with other FMW fans. So join that if you're interested. You can also find me on Twitter at BahuFMW, where I will post updates whenever I have finished a video or anything FMW news related or whatever's going on, as well as 1 minute clips of this day in history when it comes to a famous FMW match, as well as you can find me on Instagram at BahuFMW World, where I have thousands of FMW pictures posted. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you, everybody, for joining us. We will be back for the next episode, where we will go over the year 2011.